Hello, and welcome to Music Producer Conversations starring Curtis King.
Starring Nas.
Featuring, yeah, I was gonna say, featuring the young Nas, King Nas over
Nas the
there.
boss of this house.
He's the boss of this house. Oh, wait, one sec, we're gonna go live on Facebook. But man, we have so much to go over as we glance at the beauty of young Nas and
Oh.
his young life.
You got
How
no
old is
idea.
he?
He's getting ready to approach 3 months in a second.
In a second.
Yeah, in a quick second, he's about to approach 3 months. Let me open up the chat so I can see everybody in here. All
Okay.
the beautiful faces, all the beautiful producer and rapper faces all over the world. Let's go ahead and
Yusuf,
see
and
it.
we're back live. Music Producer Conversations with Curtis King and Nas. Yusuf is here. What's up, Daniel? St. Francis. What's going on? Let me open up my phone stream as well. Because YouTube's pulling shenanigans too. Certain people aren't getting notifications. But we're not going to get into that today. We're just going to focus on the positive. Not going to go conspiracy theorists. We're on Facebook, we're on YouTube, we're on Twitter, we're on Periscope. We're everywhere we can be. So, firstly, you're lucky to even have a child, I must say. It's very hard to do that nowadays,
You said to have what?
to find somebody worth it.
Oh yeah, bro. Bro, yeah. I always tell anybody that ever ask is how do you find it? You don't find it. You got to figure out what you got to become for it to come to you. That's a journey in itself. Who do you have to become? Because certain people don't want to be who they have to become to attract the woman of their dreams. They don't want to have to become that person because it's too responsible.
True. Let's say
It's
I
too
were to say,
much. Huh? I'm sorry,
You
go
said
ahead.
it's too much.
It's too much for them. I think for some people, like they look at it and they say, I can't do all that right now. Like I'm still trying to, as a man, be out here. I'm still trying to hoe a little bit. Like I think it's a lot of guys are like that. They're like, I'm still trying to, do what I'm doing. Like I ain't trying to be held down. And those restrictions are what stop them. And it can be easily as it can be easy as changing, changing what you actually your expectations are, who do you have to become. But
I'm
we
listening.
always get into that kind of stuff. What's going on, everybody?
It's so hard to share on these platforms. My goodness. Hold on. Phone is tripping out. Anyway, let me say my hellos. I know I'm not doing my routine. My bad. What's up, Blazion? So why can't they get along, he says. Just wondering. What's your philosophy on why rappers and producers can't get along, Curtis King?
Miscommunication.
Miscommunication.
Miscommunication most times because I feel like rappers have a certain energy online that they don't keep in reality. Producers are the same way. Producers, we know how we are, right? We know that most of us are very introverted. I know I'm not like every producer, but I know a lot of producers, a lot of friends of mine are very introverted. And we spend most of our hours in the studio, in our bedrooms, in our home studios, whatever the case may be. We don't spend a lot of time in public because we don't have to be. We don't have to be at the club. We don't have to be at the shows. We don't have to do with anything. We just really have to make more product. The rappers are used to always being the front and center of attention. They're used to being always, sort of, having to be personalities and charismatic. And so with that, what happens is that you're going to have to, then communication has to get better quality. And I think that that falls on both responsibilities. The quality of our conversations cannot be, you need beats? Nah. Listen to my SoundCloud first. That can't be the quality of conversations. Can you imagine a relationship that starts off like that? Like that, it's just not going to work out. So I think there's a lot of miscommunication. I think as of recent, what I have noticed, because a lot of people got familiar with my YouTube channel because I used to do these videos called, Stuff Rappers Say to Producers. And all the producers came out of the woodworks and were like, yo, like you really spoke to what I feel and you're standing up for the producers. And I was like, by all means. But what about the rappers that are not assholes? What about the rappers that actually pay for beats? What about the ones that are working 9 to 5s? They got families, but they still will invest into your beats. They still will buy. They're the reason why we have a beat leasing business. It's not because it's other producers buying our beats. It's because it's rappers buying our beats. And I felt like as of recent that a lot of the communication may fall on the responsibility of us as producers. Why? Because we have been the most damaged and the most hurt by rappers, I think in that relationship. And because of that, we have the most healing to do. Part of that healing is forgiving. Part of that healing is figuring out, how can we not only be the bigger man, but be the leaders and show these artists the way? Because I think there's a lot more business savvy producers than there are business savvy independent rappers. Just, I'm throwing a huge assumption out there,
yeah,
but I've come across a lot more, right?
Yeah, I got
so
you.
I think, yeah, I think at this point, what we got to do is, like a lot of, I had a consultation before we got on here. A lot of producers are tagging their beats like crazy in hopes that people who steal won't steal. But that's what they do. They steal. They're right. scammers. They mm-hmm. would scam if it was your beat, or scam if it was a credit card. They don't care. They just steal. Right. You can't be protecting so much from them that you ostracize and push away the people who actually have the money and want to invest into you. If you keep ostracizing them, if you keep making them feel like they're outsiders, if we don't find ways to promote them and help them along their journey, they're going to stop leasing beats, because why does it make sense to pay for something that they're not making a whole lot of money from? If they're not streaming, if they are streaming, they're not really making a whole lot of money to justify buying a $500 exclusive beat. You know, if they're not right. touring, what are they making their money on? So we have to create some kind of an ecosystem. And I'm in the process of creating something that's mm-hmm. starting off with Curtis King Radio. So anybody who leases a beat from me, you have the option to go get it mixed, come back to me, and I'll put it up on a playlist, a massive playlist that is on my beat store that gets so much traffic. Now I'm able to not only make it available to people, eventually we can even sell these songs, but I want to wait for that and kind of probably even turn into another streaming model for this. I got some ideas, but I think that it starts first with our communication on a daily basis between rappers and producers. Since I'm talking to producers right now, I think that we gotta slow down on the memes that talk about, you know, all rappers who don't pay for beats. That's what they look like. Like, we do all of these memes talking about, like, when a rapper says, I ain't paying for no beat. We talk so much more about them. We promote their, like, scandalous ways more than we promote the people who buy beats from us. And I'm guilty of that.
Right.
I'm guilty of that. We got to speak to them as human beings. You got to check up on these people. You got to, people who are taking care of your well-being. Like, I would not have a business without these rappers. Mm-hmm. So who am I to continue making these videos spoofing them? And these are my customers. Can you imagine? And I said this in a video today. Can you imagine if McDonald's got on Twitter and said, man, all of our customers are so obese. What do you think the backlash would be? People right. will be like, how are you going to talk about me? And you think I'm going to still go get some? Now, some people ain't going to care. They'll still go get a Big Mac. But most people will be like, this will be a backlash. Even Walmart. You know, Walmart is known for having a certain type of demographic that goes in there. Imagine they took advantage of that and highlighted that and said, you know, man, we got the worst customers. Who would want to do business with them?
The worst customers.
But guess what? As producers, we do that in very indirect ways by highlighting the negativity. We do that in indirect ways by saying things like, you know, man, I can't stand rappers, bro. All they do is want to get stuff for free. I can't. What is that? All rappers, or just that small minority of rappers that are not willing to buy beats from you? So I think we got to start repairing the relationship one by one.
Here's my question. Is it that they're saying that to their customers or to the people they don't want to attract? Like, you just, I think you said it right at the end, but like, well, are they just trying to repel yeah. the people who don't pay? Like, are they trying to shame them?
Yeah, I think so. But the thing about it is, it's not your job. It's not your job to or at least it shouldn't be the majority of your job to be exterminator for those who, you know, who are the scum of the business. It's not your job. Because if you do that, it'd be a full-time job. There's a lot more people out. There's a lot of people out here who want to do nothing else except for make your life difficult. Mm-hmm. So if you focus your effort on, forget about the bad apples. Focus your effort on, I have a small tribe here of rappers who are willing to buy beats. How can I give them more value that makes them want to purchase more beats? Not even just to purchase more beats. How can I give them more value that's going to make them a more profitable artist? Why? Because if they become more profitable, they have more income to come invest with me. If they made money with me by leasing my beats, they're going to want to invest more money within my business. It's an ecosystem that works, but if you spend most of your time trying to play exterminator and trying to raid out all the different, you know, rappers who ain't about nothing, right. you miss a golden opportunity to take care of the ones that actually give a damn, because one day they're going to look up and say, no malicious intent, I'm just going to stop buying beats from you because you don't focus enough in on me.
Right.
You know, I'm just here to buy beats. I'm not here for all the other politics. Why can't you highlight the rappers who actually buy stuff from me? You know, and Black Noise said the memes are funny. Yeah, they're funny as hell. I feel you. But at some point, it becomes like a parody of itself. And, you know, I had a buddy of mine that told me, he said, it's crazy how this newer generation is kind of laughing at the whole concept of tight beats, mostly because they don't understand it. But now it's like a whole parody in itself. They'll say things like Fortnite tight beat. I'm not going to talk to my mom type beat. My mom does no shit type beat. Like, that's now the parody, and that's right. Dangerous because that will now become part of the regular vernacular of a new generation. Now they'll come into the out the gate as rappers and say, I don't buy beats. You know, I got courses that teach me how to make. I don't need to do this. So I think that if you want to have longevity in this, and this is only for those that want to see longevity, and I think we got to start building these relationships up, because no matter where we go as a business, no matter where we go internet wise, no matter what happens, we're going to always need to have those relationships, or right. Things are going to go a different direction, and we're going to have to find a whole nother business for us to generate income off of independently. I'm just saying, you want to take care of that now before it gets too late.
There's a lot that you touched on, so we're gonna have to break that into pieces. One was that, you know, the model of free, so we can start there. But then let me take notes before I forget, actually. So the free / I guess kind of the type B conversation, but then we can talk about content ID, like the new way we keep track of free stuff on the internet, even if they were to steal your beat and you upload it to YouTube, those kind of things. There was another point I was going to say. So until that pops into my brain, let's start with the model of free. Bashing. I forgot what it was, so I have to think on it a little bit. But bashing people for free. So free, remember the no free beats whole movement thing back in the day? Why do you think people are trying to stop that? Here's my quick kind of philosophy on it. The people who say that the internet's dead and that type beats are dead and all this, they gave up on the battle. It's because if you look up type beat, any type beat, Cash Money AP is probably going to pop up.
Sure.
And congratulations to Cash Money AP. It gets like 7 million views per month off of free something something type beat. That's his whole business model right now. So he has that keyword on lock. It's not the only way to get traffic. And people in the music producer community, they have no idea how to run a business. So we look to people like Johnny Giuliano to run a business, or like Superstar O, or whoever was like popping back in the day. We would look to them for the business model because we have no idea what we're doing. It's monkey see, monkey do. Because when the way you get brought into an industry, the way you're indoctrinated into an industry, that's your model of how it works. So whoever introduced you to the musical world, that's how you think the whole world of music works. And, you know, a lot of people are just copying because they don't know any better. Like the whole lease term thing, like, was it License Lounge or?
License Lounge, yeah. Which now I got to be careful how I talk, because I might actually be doing business with them to help advance the entire culture. I had an opportunity to talk to the owner and his partner. Are both the owners of the company, and their vision is a lot different than what I anticipated when I saw it on the website. This is something that can actually be a beautiful, beautiful situation for all producers, not just industry, for online producers. Yes, do they limit their access to online to internet producers, right? Not internet, industry producers, yes. Mm-hmm. But there's a few things that they discuss that leads me to believe that life can be really good for us in a second, if we're able to move outside of our comfort zones and try some new things.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm glad you have that intel. Again, me personally, I don't owe any company, meaning that companies, you know, who want favors from BusyWorks Beats need to operate like every other business. You know, like, for example, these companies want to work. They pay for Facebook ads, but won't pay anybody else for ads. Like, we're not doing stuff for free. I'm not doing stuff for free. Anyway. My whole thing about that is because I'm sick of these offers. Hey, review my plugin. All I'm going to do is give you a license to my plugin. Put it on your channel because we told you to. I'm not your slave. Okay. So I had to get that out there.
No, I feel you. Game, I know you by now. I know you don't play. You don't play with. I know you don't care what these companies are talking about offering. You don't play. You've built yourself up a respectable business that deserves the respect. And everything that you're saying, like, every time I bring these things up, I'm not saying it in opposition at all. I'm looking at it like, the brother, you are an inspiration to me. So as I deal with these companies, I'm being very tactful, because I'm like, is there a bigger play than just myself here? Because if I think about myself, I wouldn't work with any of them. You know what I'm saying?
I got you. Your journey is your journey. I'm just trying to separate myself from the equation.
Sure.
And yeah, again, we work with Razor, like UAD, Waves. You know, I'm looking at those kind of companies. It doesn't matter. We're both two different people, but I respect Absolutely. You and love you like a brother.
Man,
so let's talk about
brother,
type
man.
Beats. Well, let's before we get to type beats, actually, let's talk about free. Remember the no free beats movement?
Mm-hmm.
Man, that got huge. Now, here's the thing. Again, they're saying no free. Okay, so we have to talk about a lot of things. Okay, firstly, what are your thoughts on undercutting? Like, the idea of undercutting. Price wars.
I have to tell you, I don't think that... Okay, this is going to sound really naive, but I feel like it's non-existent. It's a non-existent factor, because if you're providing a niche sound, if you're providing something that nobody else can get from anybody else, who cares what the next person is paying for? It's almost like, I always like to use like luxury automobiles. If somebody's paying, you know, X amount of dollars for a Lamborghini, but a car company like a Hyundai is giving you the car for $10,000, like, that doesn't stop somebody from wanting that Lamborghini. That doesn't, if they can afford it, that doesn't stop them from wanting that. You know, it's a matter of where, what tiers of quality, what type of niche is being attacked. And I think that if you're in a business, if you're getting in the business of leasing beats and you're only making beats that you think people will want to buy, you're not adding your own special sauce, your own uniqueness to it, I think, yes, price wars are a real thing. But for producers that are like myself, like, I don't, like, I care about what's on the radio. I listen to it to know the tempos and know some of the basics, but I don't need to take the entire anatomy of it to be successful in now today's market. All I got to do, like, I listen to the Kanye album, the Kid C Ghost album, the Pusha T album. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's just being around music for so long. Immediately, I started getting these combinations of sounds that wouldn't even make sense on their project that makes sense to me, and I start creating. Why? Because I just love making music, and I love absorbing music, absorbing energy, and putting it out into music. So that being said, what I create from there, it may not be a Kanye West type beat, it may not be a Kid Cudi type beat, but it's a Curtis King type beat. And you can't get that from anywhere else. Somebody can imitate it, but they will never get the true authenticity, because most of the time when I'm making beats, I'm not worried about like my, I never worry about my competition, actually. I'm just sitting up here creating the best thing possible that I can. How can I make this more visually appealing, audibly appealing to a rapper? When I'm making a beat, I'm not thinking about how can I make this beat better. I'm thinking about what will make this beat make a rapper sound larger than life. And I think that's where the foundation starts, is you're serving your customer. You know, when Nike's putting together these tennis shoes for your feet, they're not saying, how can I make this shoe look nicer? If you're an athlete, they're trying to figure out, how can I make this shoe more comfortable around your ankle if you're a track runner? If you're a basketball player that's doing a lot of vertical leaping, how can I make this shoe fit customized to you? Why does that not apply to us? You know, and I think that's the way that I have gone about it, is that now I'm starting to think of it like, how can I make the lives of the people who invest into my beats? Like, we got to stop making these generalized statements that come from a very bitter place in our heart. All rappers steal. All rappers are narcissistic. No, the rappers that you've been dealing with are like that. You need to change your environment. Find some other rappers. There are people out here that I've had 2-hour conversations with for the first time. Never met them before in a day of my life. But because they were willing to invest into my music, it opened me up to a conversation with them about their career. We just talk. And then I get off the call with them, and then I look at my PayPal, and they've invested in over $1,500 worth of beats because of a 30-minute conversation. Not all rappers are the same. We got to stop saying that, because what if they said all producers are all type beat producers are copycatters? None of them are original. That'd be bull. That'd be bull.
And I have to write this. I had to put my notes on a separate screen so I could see them all.
No worries.
Here's some good questions before I get into, you know, our notes. Make humanity great again, since rappers have it too easy, especially with the reduced lyrical standards nowadays. But here's my question back to the community, is who makes the song? Like, if you listen to some, I make this example all the time, some Beyonce tracks without the singing, you're like, who made this beat? Like, who would ever hop on this beat?
Right.
And it's not to say that the beat's whack or that Beyonce, whatever, it's to say that it requires both. You know, so what's your perspective on songwriting, not just beat making, but like songwriting? Right. I think the art of songwriting takes a while. As you can see in these live streams with 808s and Mermaids making the mixtape, takes forever to like even get a beat going and then write the melody over it. Not even the lyrics. It takes forever.
Right.
And it takes a lot of skill.
Look, so, everybody that has a hand in a hit song, everybody that has a hand in a hit song is a contributing force. And I think when producers say things like, without my beat, this song will be nothing, it comes from a place of bitterness. It comes from a place of scarcity. It doesn't come from a place of abundance. It doesn't come from a place of, I know that I can create more. It comes from a place from, without me, you wouldn't be what it is. And when I caught that energy, and I've said these words before, when I caught that energy and I saw that, I was like, that's my bad. That's not a rapper's bad. That's my bad. Take responsibility first. Yeah. I'm telling you, literally every single entrepreneurial book that I have read at some point in time talks about taking personal responsibility as being one of the main aspects that you have to change in the beginning to become successful. Look, I'm looking at people in here who are saying the complete opposite. And look, I can't be in control of your journey. All I can do is plant the seed for you. And if it makes sense to you, cool. If it doesn't, you got to go on your journey. You'll figure it out eventually. But you got to take responsibility for everything, even stuff that's not your fault. Yes, you're not at fault, but it's still your responsibility how you react to it. A drunk driver hits you while you're walking on the street, it is not your fault, but it's your responsibility to get yourself back to 100% health.
Right.
Going in with that mentality into business was the best thing for me, because now I look at it and I say, no, without me, this song is still a well-produced acapella. Right? With this person's pull, like I used to say the thing, like I think I even said it on my video yesterday or today, that you know, rappers are not having number one albums with acapellas. But I'm pretty sure if Beyonce decided to do nothing but an acapella album tomorrow and release it out to iTunes, and she just had nothing but harmonies and all these different things, and she's like doo-wop, doo-wop, like the old school like doo-wop, if she had nothing but her vocals, they would be the number one album in the country. Right? And that doesn't say anything. That doesn't say that we don't need producers. That doesn't say that, you know, the producers don't need artists. All that's saying is that there are anomalies to everything. Mm-hmm. So you have to make sure that you take responsibility for it first. And I think part of that is understanding that when you say things like, without the beat, these songs wouldn't be anything, that's bull. These songwriters spend their time in here. There's a lot of songwriters that never get credit because they're not the face. For a long time, Jill Scott, one of my favorite singers, we would have never heard from her because when she came into the game was like, if you're not the game, but when she came into the industry, they were like, if you don't look the part of a skinny, you know, beautiful woman, you cannot be in the forefront. They wouldn't let her, no matter how beautiful her voice was. Thank God she stayed around and eventually launched her own career, but she was ghostwriting for other people. So you got to think, it's not just the rappers that you think are narcissistic or the songwriters who are blowing up and forgetting about the producers. There's people that are in the middle of there, right? There's people who are the songwriters that sometimes never get the credit. You never get to hear from them. Their story is no different from your story as a producer. You feel like you're forgotten about? You feel like people don't give you your credit? How many times have you looked to see the songwriting credits and then saw a name that you didn't recognize and went and researched them? Think about it. We're not the only ones. So we all contribute to the end product. So I think that's why it's important that we take responsibility first and realize that we can't just say, oh yeah, without me, y'all not. That comes from a place of scarcity and not abundance.
Yeah, well, first I want to say, what's up, Stefan? What's going on, man? He helps out behind the scenes. So for example, you just brought up something perfect. So without Stefan and Jenna helping out BusyWorks Beats, it wouldn't be able to operate the way it does, you know, with ease, without stress. You know, you get the content you need because I can timely give it to you on time because of Stefan and Jenna's help. So do people know them on a massive scale? Not necessarily, but it doesn't mean they don't deserve the credit. So shout out to Stefan, man. Love you, man. So what was I going to say? Oh, I have notes. My bad. Dang, can you get back to the main topic of what you just said? Because I went on a little tangent.
Basically, everybody's contribution to a hit song, everybody's contribution from songwriters to producers.
Here's what I was going to say. Is without the beat, I wrote it in my notes, without the beat, the rapper won't be much. That's kind of the philosophy. But whoever is producing the song, production doesn't mean you're making the beat. So Dr. Dre can have a bunch of musicians, a bunch of beat makers in a room, grab an artist, and he shapes the way the end product is. So he's the producer of it all. So if anybody's, you know, how can I put this? What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say that it's up to the producer. So if you want to blame anybody, it's the producer of the thing, not necessarily the beat maker. The beat maker is not the person who puts it together, per se, the total picture. It's the producer of the thing. Mm-hmm. So a lot of beat makers are not producers of a thing. They're not creating the product. They're just doing half the product, sending it off to somebody else to finish it off. They send it off to somebody else to get mixed. And ultimately, the mixing engineer in that case could even be seen as the producer, so to speak, because they're meshing the ideas, creative ideas. It really changes, you know, depending on the song and the environment. But I would say put it on the producers then, not the people, not the cogs in the machine. Here's a question. I know we're kind of going back, but I wrote these down because they're important notes. Black Noise says, why don't we adjust our leasing terms towards streaming views and plays instead of units? So for example, a lot of license and leasing terms says you can only sell 2,000 units. And really there's no way for anybody to track that. So I don't even know right. why you have that in your contract, for one. But for right. two is, what if they switch that to now 2,000 views on YouTube and now they have to buy another license? How do they police? I don't know what his question is, but I guess.
Yeah.
What if that
why are we not basically why are we not coming? Why are we not coming into 2018? Because I think that a lot of people are seeing the game shift very fast and they don't know how to adjust. If the labels don't know how to adjust, you gotta think that a lot of people who are just kind of getting started in the business are just kind of copying the model they've seen before. Even me, I gotta go to my website. I gotta go to my website and change around units to streams, even though it says that on my license agreement on Airbit, I've just been slow to move on it. But you're absolutely right, is that it's time to now adjust that. People are not selling units. They're not selling just, you know, one individual song at a time. You know, they are streaming this and putting it up there. And sometimes it only gets two or three streams. But that's my point, is that we can't just leave them out there in the graveyard because they don't have enough of a following. The following has to start with something. There's a reason they came to you. You're part of the value system for their project. If you're a big producer in the leasing game, it means something to get a beat by Curtis King, a beat by Tone Jones, a beat by Superstar O. That means something, right? If it means something, it's up to us to make it mean something even more, over-deliver on the value. Maybe that's sharing our network somehow, some way, creating a network that brings people together, something like that. Along those lines has to be made for not just the survival, but for the growth and for another revitalization of this industry. Because you can't just stay stagnant. You can't think that you can do the same thing over and over again, especially because, you know, I know it may not be this for every producer in the game right now getting in with a leasing business. It's easy money. This is super easy money. And I'm always skeptical of easy money because I'm like, when is it going to dry up or when is something going to happen? So you have to always be ready to sort of lead the way and try new things. Is everything going to work? No, but you got to try new things. And so I'm in a place right now where it's like, okay, I'm not going back to the industry. I know there's producers who have left the leasing industry to go to the, left the leasing business to go back to the industry. There's no way in hell. There's no way in hell that you're going to see me going back there. What I'm going to do though is continue living this lifestyle that I'm living, which is creating a business that gives me my ultimate freedom. Some people want to go deal with that politic. I don't want to have not another day dealing with politics over there. I've lived in LA. Right. I've lived and I've been around the environment. I've seen how these people do, some people do business. It's not to make a blanket statement that everybody does that, but I've seen enough to where I'm like, that lifestyle does not match up with the lifestyle I ideally see for myself. And that's how I judge my success. I don't judge your success about how much money you're making. I judge your success about, if are you happy? Are you fulfilled? Are you living in an environment that ultimately you want to do? If you're doing that and you don't have to worry about these things, you're successful to me. So for me right now, I'm like, okay, the lifestyle that I want to have, which is to be able to work on music, turn around, pick my son up, go out, play catch with him, and come back and not miss a dollar, not miss a dime, and still generate income when I'm out, that's the life that I want. I love it. I love it. Being able to deal with rappers on a regular basis, I love it. Being able to generate income while I'm, you know, on the beach. I mean, it's like the most typical thing. It's like the
on the beach, yeah.
You know, the infomercial push. But being able to do that is I can't deny that feeling that I have for it, but that's what I want. Maybe you want something different.
Nothing beats San Diego beaches, though. If you're on a San Diego beach, bruh,
Bruh.
You will put your laptop on the bench and then be on the beach and then go back to your laptop.
But I know Game was out there curling his toes out there like, oh.
I was like, this is a beach. This makes me respect a beach. Like, San Diego is the pinnacle of beaches, in my opinion, from what I've seen. You know, yeah. I haven't been to the Bahamas, Jamaica, wherever yet, but San Diego, good Lord, that is a beautiful place.
Really is.
Okay, there's a lot of good questions in here, so let me copy and paste them over so we can keep them in our archive so we can tap into them. So again, I always talk and then I forget that last tail thing I was going to go off of with you. Can you just repeat that last millisecond of what you said?
Just basically about having the freedom to live the lifestyle that I want.
Okay, that's what it was. Industry. So you've seen how much control you can have over your destiny when you have your own business and you run your own systems and do your own thing. When you're in the industry, you're under somebody else's control. Well, I'm not saying you're under somebody else's control, but you don't have control of certain decisions, which creates variables that you can't control. So now there's an X in the equation. Now there's another Y in the equation. It's not 1 + 1 = 2. Now it's 1X + 1Y = Z. You don't even know anymore.
Right.
And it's not predictable. Now I know some people are quote unquote leaving the internet to go over to the industry, but the majority of their money comes from the internet, which is hilarious. I think those people are literally kind of telling a story, a half truth, because they're saying there's no money on the internet, but their whole business is operating on the internet while they're trying to do this industry thing. So you really got to look at what people are doing and not saying, because a lot of people out here are just misleading you tremendously.
And can I add before you continue that, can I add it? Because this is a very important portion that I really want to make sure that I beat over the head is that if these people that you're listening to, whoever it is, if they led you to this business and then just left, what does that say about their leadership? What does that say about the way that they view you? Right? Now, I'm not saying somebody has to tell you their every move. I'm not saying they have to take you along the ride for everything they do. But for somebody to tell you, no, this is where the money is at. Producers, come here, come do your thing. And then turn around and be like, ah, ain't no money in that. What about the people that you encourage to buy your products? What about the people who spent hundreds and hundreds of dollars with consultations so that they can learn how to do this? You gonna leave these people hanging? You gonna just leave them behind because you found your cash cow? I can't do that. I can't lead all these producers into this business and say, yo, man, that's the best freedom I ever had. I'm so happy. And then you see me up here in these industry studios and it's like, what was the whole advocate thing about? You know what I'm saying? It's like somebody who's a vegan, an advocate for, never eating meat, never eat meat. And then you see them in a steakhouse grand opening, like cutting the string. What are you doing?
Cutting the string.
What are you, not cutting the string, like eating a big old steak sandwich. What are you doing?
Right.
And that's what I feel like. And the thing is, I don't want to make these people out to be bad people. I just think that they make bad decisions like we all do. And it's not bad decisions for them, but for the sake of the community, it's not a good decision, because what about the people you left behind? What about the people who created their beat stores because of you? What about the people who said, F the industry, I'm going to go get it my own way? And now you left them behind to what? Do what you're doing? Guess what? There's only a small window of opportunity for people going into the industry. Because like Game said, that's somebody else's system. And if somebody decides at any point they don't want you in that system, type your name in, you're blackballed. There is no situation for you. Can't nobody blackball you from the internet. You can go get a new logo from Fiverr. If something happened crazy, like say for instance, that whole FL Studio piracy thing was so detrimental to my brand that I couldn't make another video. Mm-hmm. I could come back as a King Steaks, King Steak Beats, King Steak Beats, and you would never know. You would never know. So that's my point, is that you have more life, you have more opportunities within the internet. And why would you jump ship from something that, if you look at it from an e-commerce standpoint, it's making exponentially $100 billion more every year, right? Mm-hmm. Now, is the art of us leasing beats and selling beats online, is that shifting? Yes. Is it drying up? Come on now. That's not even a question that I have to feel like I even have to honor. I think if anything, you have to look at it from your own standpoint and say, okay, so Curtis led me to go lease my beats. But one thing he said from the beginning is do not use that as one egg in one basket. Don't put all your eggs in that one basket. I always said use it as an opportunity to create other businesses. Right. So for me, the YouTube channel became a business once I used my leasing money to buy a camera. High-quality camera, high-quality lens, a lighting system. I went and bought all that with my Beat leasing money. Oh, my bad. I got somebody hitting from DJ Boo. I got to hit them back, actually. But as you explain this, the YouTube, the one-on-one consultations, because I found success. Now I have some advice to give to producers who want to get into this. That becomes another stream. You talk about merchandise because people are so passionate about the brand. They want to wear the brand, the hats, merchandise becomes a part of it. But that all came from the foundation of selling beats. Had I never sold a beat, we wouldn't be talking about this, but the money is really a tool that opens up other opportunities. Beat leasing is another opportunity that if you decide you want to go online and make your money, there should not be a leave the online space. Unless you got something going on in your personal life that you can't deal with, there should be no leaving this. This is your industry. You know what I'm saying? That's like going to the NBA and saying, I'm really successful in the NBA, but I want to go to overseas because I want to make I want to make less money and I want it to be a little bit harder for me. I think that's what I'm rocking with. I don't want the endorsements and I just want to kind of be over here. But you're finding leverage, you're finding success in this. Either that or you're not finding success. It's the only things I can sort of conclude from that. But
right.
That's my spiel. Let me send these emails off. I'm listening to you talk. I'm sorry.
So you wanted to take a call real quick? I can mute your mic.
I have to send them over some links via email because I got another article going up on DJ Booth today. Oh, cool. But this is the second email they sent.
There it is. Speaking of other companies, I forgot. We're going to be giving away $2,000 worth of Studio Link plugins. So shout out to Studio Link. We teamed up with Evan, who's the owner over at Studio Link. And he was like, you know what? I want to give away some plugins. So he's like, you know, we're going to give away $2,000. I think it's all the plugins. I think it's all of the plugins, like one of each. I think that's how it's going to work. And I have to ask him if we're going to give it to one winner or like multiple winners. But that's going to be coming soon, a new contest for Studio Link, who came out with Trophies by Brian Michael Cox. Storch has his own plugin. Who else has a plugin? Collie Park has a plugin with them. Funky Fingers by Zaytoven. So we'll put those details out, and I'll be in ATL June 23rd with Trizza and Nam. Trizza and Sound Oracle at the Producer Power Summit that they put on and invited me out, and I said sure, I'll come. So we're going to be there June 23rd in ATL, so you can come meet us. I'll leave the details on a different page. All right, but like you said, to me, when I think industry stuff or like going to the bigger studio or making songs even, that's I need the luxury of time. Like Pusha T said, he made his album because he had the luxury of time.
Mm-hmm.
Pusha T wasn't just making albums just to make albums. He had to have enough time to invest in the album. There's so many questions. Hold on. Hold says, invest back into your business if it's going well and expand it. That way the bottom line of the value will increase. True.
I think absolutely. That was
the question. So,
what's the question? Okay.
Here's a question, my bad. So I'm going backwards. So I did write your questions down from the chat. So you didn't get neglected. Noah West says, so is it agreed that industry producers and online producers are different?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's been the last the last hour or so we've been talking. That's really what it's about. Yeah, is that we are different in the way that we generate our income. We are the same in that we all create music. But we are different because we operate by different rules and by different, not even standards, but by different. We basically use different techniques to raise visibility of our brands, right? So industry producers don't believe in using tight beats because they feel like it devalues their own brand, their own uniqueness, their own originality. And type beat producers say, well, no, this is the same thing that bloggers use when they say top 10 chefs on Food Network and they make a blog post about it. Or when somebody has a YouTube video that says top 5 reasons you should start playing Fortnite. They're using high ranking search terms to leverage free traffic through through a process called search engine optimization to basically bring in people that could be potentially fans and customers of their work. There's nothing wrong with that, but there's something wrong with it when producers do it. Why? Because we have these purist views of what hip hop should be, what producers should be. You need to follow what the legends have done. If you do it a different way, you know, you're devaluing the game. No, I'm evolving this culture. We're evolving it as online producers. Right. You can't expect that if you look at albums nowadays, they're probably circulating between five or six producers at the most, maybe, right? And most of those slots are being taken up by the people who are the most like Metro Boomins, the Sonny Digitals, the you know, whoever's the hot names at the times. And you can't expect that the risk in trying to get there is not bigger than it is online. There's just way too many people out here to service. People who need your sound. They don't need Metro Boomin's beats. They want your sound. Right? Because you bring out a certain emotion in their music. And because music is such an emotional connection, that's something that you just can't deny. You know, it's right. Something you cannot deny.
I think most producers just have a fundamental marketing problem. That's why I put up these videos recently, because they don't understand that, like, type beat is only one type. Okay, not even, like, the idea of bringing in Fortnite and all those, you know, broad topics, but just the word type beat. Like, they think it has to say type beat because they think that's the only way. What's up, Craftmasters? I meant to shout you out. Craftmaster Productions from Studio1Tutorials.com. I meant to shout you out earlier, my bad. Now I lost my train of thought. The idea is that people only search something, something type beat. That's not the only keyword in the world people search. People also search hip-hop instrumental. They also search rap instrumental. They also search something, something remake. They also search, what are some other keywords people do? Mood music, background music. They also search free something, something beat. It's not always something, sad, something type beat.
Sad piano beat. Sad, yes. Emotional piano beat. That's a huge one.
Mm-hmm. Indigo says, what plugin do I use for microtuning? Guitar Rig is good for that. And I think Ableton comes with a tuner inside of that. Just to answer your question real quick on Facebook. I had to kind of cater to the Facebook audience because they don't think we respond to them because we can't see the screen, but now we can. Yes, I think there's so many opportunities, like you said, to expand, and people aren't embracing this. You have, for example, us putting this video up, we can get in front of the eyes of any film director around the world. They can just happen to stumble upon this video and now know who we are, know our personalities, and know our demeanor based on this conversation. So we are investing in that relationship indirectly through the means that we create content. What I mean is, it's not me going directly to a film director and saying, here's our video that we created together. We didn't put it online. It's just me and Curtis King. Here you go. Giving it to him direct versus him kind of stumbling upon it or finding it in other different ways. With the internet, you know, to keep my words short, with the internet, you can reach 3.5 billion people. 3.5 billion people have the internet. I looked up the stats. That's half the world has the internet. So if you can't figure a way to get in front of how much is 1% of 3.5 billion? Let's do some math.
You gonna pull that calculator out. My brain ain't working that like that today.
Yeah, I'm gonna use Google. 1% of 3.5 billion. This is 1% is 300 and wait, 000 35 million. That's 35 million potential customers. Just 1%. Just 1% of the world is 35 million potential customers. And we're not even, that's 1%. So I think we're boxing ourselves into these traditional narratives that are fed to us through this industry producer kind of illusion that they create in the first place. Mm-hmm. And make it seem like it's, there's so many aspects. Let me just keep it at 3.5 million potential people. Okay, uh-huh. June 23rd, talked about that luxury of time. So here's the next question from Mongo. He says, so what leasing business, beat placements, and movie TV placement companies do we go to? Here's another thing about like the go-to people. There's no one website you go to that does everything. There's just, it's not how it works in this world. There is no one place.
But yeah. Do you have any suggestions? People are looking for an easy answer. They're looking for the easy way out. Like there's no easy, you got to work. You got to work. I don't know why people want the easy, like, show me a website I can submit to off and then I'm going to start getting placements.
That's not how it
works. The placements that I've gotten on TV, on with TV Sync and License, have all been from shaking hands with people. They've all been from, like, unexpected times where somebody was like, oh, by the way, this guy right here is in charge of the music for this for this he's in charge of the music department for this Vans skateboarding video. I just happened to be at the Vans event because one of my friends was behind the scenes there. I came with a CD because they said just in case it may happen. Like, these websites can't promise you anything. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a website called, I believe it's called Music Dealers. I've got a few placements with them, but I don't know how much that's attributed to the fact that I have a name. Mm-hmm. I don't think anybody can promise you the same thing. There's no substitute for hard work. There's no substitute for getting out there. If that's what you want to do, go in those environments, go in a studio audience, right? Just be there, be in the environment, see what it's all about. Go to these TV shows that you want to be placed in, you know, see what kind of music is being played. See, you know, go try to check the credits at the, like when you're watching a basketball game or a football game, every time they play music, somebody's getting credited, but you see it when those credits go super fast at the end of the game. Look at the credits, see who music was. It was, go find a producer, watch how they move. If you can, if you're lucky enough to connect with them, talk to them. Mm-hmm. You know, they'll more than likely tell you the truth about how it is. And I tell you, 90% of them are not doing it because they're going through a website. It's because of somebody they know. There's no substitute for hard work. You're going to have to just put the work in.
Right. Even the websites like Taxi, the people you submit your music to have relationships with different companies. Like, they'll go pitch your song to Fox News or go pitch your song to ESPN. They have relationships with these bigger companies, and they manually go out and sell your music, well, try to sell your music to them. So at the end of the day, it comes down to relationships regardless. It's a lot better if you have the power in your hands and control when you build your brand from the ground up. We're showing you how to do this. This is what the latest videos on the channel are all about. Like, apply that stuff. Stop watching the stuff and apply it, because that's probably why you're not getting the results. You're not doing anything with the stuff we're teaching you how to do. Right. You said you learned everything. Cynthia says, I learned everything I need to know off Busy Works Beats. Shout out to you. Appreciate that.
But look at that. Busy. Again, look how super dope that is. The new education system is online. We're teaching one another. Mm-hmm. Who better to learn? I don't want to learn about how to market myself as a rapper to somebody that doesn't know what it means to be a rapper. I don't want to hear somebody who's not putting any fingers to keys. And that's how I used to be, like, back when Guitar Center would sell these VHS tapes, you know, how to become a home studio producer. I don't want to learn from the guy that never made my type of music. He's going to tell me stuff like, having your music go into the red is a bad thing. But I make trap music. How is that going to appeal? I make hip hop that's like banging drums. It's a different art. Like, distortion becomes part of the art form. What are you going to tell me for that? Keep watching the next VHS. Like, that's not what we're here for.
Look, there's companies, you know what I'm saying? Like, right,
put VHS too. And that's companies, right? Yeah, that's sad. But that's what I'm saying is that now we are the new teachers. We are the new Udemy courses. We are the new, thought leaders in this. And who better to trust than somebody who's finding success doing it right now? I don't want to hear from somebody who has a concept, who read it in a book. You can share some information, but I don't want to invest money with you if you don't have some kind of a skin in the game. Show me what you have done. Show me that you have gone through this. That's why my consultations are much different than going to somebody else who is like on some, you know, I know a lot about the music business because I've been around it. There's CEOs that don't know what we know. Why? Because they've never been in the trenches. They never sat down and had a conversation with an artist and cared more than cared more about their mental health than what's going on in their wallet. So you can't, that person can't give you that. You know what I'm saying? So the new teachers, think about basketball games now and how they're no longer hiring people who go to announcer schools. They're hiring athletes, because who better to tell me about the sport of basketball than people who've played it?
Right.
You know, so.
I'm reading, sorry, Facebook comments because they just loaded. True Indie Love. Mm-hmm. My bad. I have to keep up with the comments on Facebook. I agree. It's. For example, I came from nothing. Like, I was in my parents' extra bedroom with nothing but a laptop on my hot lap. I remember it was the heat. It was the height of the summer, and the laptop was hot. It was burning like lines in my thighs. And then I had the broken mouse wheel, and I'm sitting there trying to make beats and figure it out. I just remember feeling really stuck, like there was a ceiling above my head. Mm-hmm. And once I started reading books, doing more research, I felt like that ceiling expanded, so I didn't feel so trapped. Like, I felt trapped and depressed and all these things. But again, I came from nothing. All I had was that laptop and a piece of paper. I remember the piece of paper, and I sat there and wrote out my whole website. I wrote out, this is what the purpose of this is here to do, blah, blah, blah. I wrote it all out and made it come to life by taking action. You know, law of attraction, the word action is in the word attraction. A lot of people don't take action. You have to, here's the thing. Now, I have more videos coming, but I'll save that for the other videos because it's too much to explain. There are other companies out here like trying to make Ableton Trap, how to make a 21 Savage type beat in Ableton Live. And they're like, all right, hello, welcome to, not even saying their voice, I'm just kind of making up
voice. But we get, you gotta bring their voice into it because that's an important factor.
They're like, all right, today we're gonna start making EDM trap. All right, first you need your hard snare. we're gonna look up a snare and
you need
it's
some
like
snare
they don't know
up.
The first thing about the trap culture.
This is the part where you pump your fist. You probably can't tell how excited I am right now, but I'm very excited. So here we go. Yeah, you don't want. That's what I don't want.
It's not even a white-black thing. It's a sincerity thing. Like, me and Curtis King have a pure intention to uplift the producer community. Again, that's why we align, because we resonate on that truth that we're truly trying to lift you up. A lot of these companies are just trying to extract, and they know how to manipulate emotions to extract. That's all they're doing. They're wolves in sheep's clothing. And it's like, they'll do anything to kind of throw out this pseudo content, like hire some Joe Schmo from like Kentucky who has no interest in the producer community at all.
At all. Just make videos. He has interest in the money. He'll be like, you know what? I don't even listen to 21 Savage, but I'll study it long enough for this paycheck. Yeah. And that is poisonous.
But even here, I have to kind of combat that for a second, because some people may say, okay, Game, you don't listen to EDM. Why do you make EDM tutorials? But my intention is to uplift the producer community. So if you want to learn sound design for EDM, I got to figure out a way to teach you sound design for EDM, regardless of if I like it or not.
I got to play devil's advocate on that and say that you have already provided so much foundational evidence that no matter what genre it is, you have value to give. For somebody who comes in here and all they know is a blues timing of music, or all they know is like metal music, they don't have some of the instincts that you will have because you have already invested yourself in these multifaceted foundational educational tools. You've done that already. So when you're telling me advice about sound design, that doesn't just apply to me, the rapper, the hip-hop producer. I'm sure you've had many a comments where people come to you and say, I don't even make beats, but I find value in this. Why is that? Because you're providing a foundational value that these examples we're using, you know, they don't necessarily have that because they're thinking money first. And you know the type, because you'll get there and you'll see like, no, that doesn't even really make any sense. Like, what are you talking about? This is not even like, I think before you invest in anything, I think it's a rule for anything. Before you invest into anyone or anything, it's the same thing for any marketer that I'm into. I want to know what kind of business he's done. I want to know what his position is, his or her position is in their field before I go invest my money with it.
Yeah.
If I see a success that is exponentially better than mine, I have a lot to learn from this person. Mm-hmm. You know, but if it's somebody who's like struggling a level below me, I'm sure there's things I can still take from it. But for the most part, you know, you can't go uphill thinking downhill thoughts. And certain people just operate that because that is their DNA. And they don't even know it. They still got to grow from there.
My mentor told me, now before I get into my response to you, well, actually, I'll do it after. My mentor told me, he's like, don't look at the title of the book, look at who wrote it. But at the same time, there are a lot of successful people, and this is what we do. For example, people are so worried about placements. I went from having nothing in an extra bedroom and a laptop to being partnered with the greatest gaming laptop computer company ever, Razer. Number one in so many categories. So how does that happen? And it's the stuff we're teaching you, how to bring this dream into the reality. Now, you mentioned 2 seconds ago, I always lose my, when I go on tangents, I lose that last thought. What was that last thing you said? The last 2 milliseconds of it?
I guess basically prospecting the people that you're getting research from. Uphill thoughts and downhill. All
right, was I lose that thoughts about real that? Fast. I get them fast and I lose them fast.
Oh, no, I'm gonna shut up. Go ahead.
So we can learn from the people who went in the trenches. Like, Curtis King has lived that life, has been to shows. Did you put it on your own shows, or you were at other people's shows?
You went in terms of, like, as an
performing?
Artist?
Performing as an artist, yeah.
I haven't thrown that many shows, but I've been a part of probably Yeah, a lot of like, I've been a part of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds upon shows that I either had a hand in a flyer, I had a hand in performing, I had a hand in, you know, working the door sometimes. I've done it all when it came to shows. And one of my best friends is actually a show promoter. So I've seen it from his perspective, too.
So you got that experience. You got the real raw experience, not a CEO telling him to do stuff. They don't know what they're talking about because they don't understand what it takes to understand an audience. They're disconnected. And Curtis King understands what his people want. Then you got his experience with his Frankenstein, right?
Right, making Frankenstein beats on the laptop.
making beats on the laptop, both in-house and, you know, in certain studio sessions. And in, what was it, the mansion of somebody's house, you said? And like,
Hit Boy's house. Hit Boy, one of the most successful producers from our particular area. He produced, Niggas in Paris. He produced Drop the World with Eminem and Lil Wayne. He's produced for Beyonce. He produced for all these folks. And he moved to huge house when I went there at the time in Tarzana, which is like really really rich part of California. And to experience what the house looked like, to experience what it felt like, you can't help but feel to yourself, how would I feel if this was mine? Do I still have the same feelings I have when I'm looking at houses online? Do I still fantasize about it, or do I look at it for the reality that it is? I looked around. There were still dirty clothes by laundry. There was still, you know, walls that had certain stains on them. I mean, it wasn't a dirty place. It was just like a normal home. They were just bigger. And so when I saw that, the reality set in that this would still not be enough. I would have worked this hard to get here and be so distracted by work, and not realize that even this is not what I was looking for. This is not enough.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I have a good question / objection to answer. And I agree. It's like, I was in that 6-bedroom mansion, like in La Jolla, which is like one of the richest places in California. Like you said, Tarzana's one, Calabasas, probably Beverly Hills, those type of places. Sure. I was in that mansion in La Jolla, San Diego. It's great. The hot tub is wonderful. Actually, at the end of the day, it's perfect to get in the hot tub, but like 6-bedroom, it's empty. Like there's literally nothing to do. Like if you're not creating something, it feels like it's empty. It's just like having a regular house, like in the smaller, it's the same exact thing, just in a house with more doors that you're not going to be in because you can only be in one room at a time. And I've been in a mansion in Miami. It's the same exact thing. If you're not doing something, creating that fulfillment, it doesn't mean a thing. I don't care how many cars you got, how many houses you got. It really is so empty without this creative process and fulfillment. Now, I do have to answer a good question from Nick Webbs. He says, what would you say to peeps that think you're in it just to sell your programs? I don't see you that way, but I could see someone getting into that argument. I would say that I have to sell programs in order to keep BusyWorks Beats alive. You know, businesses take money to, in order for me to help you, I need money. In order for me to run my Bible charity, it needs money. Not only money, but I have to know enough people to give the Bibles to. That takes influence, which takes a business, which takes growing a concept. We were doing this before YouTube even monetized our videos. So, you know, it started with YouTube monetization because I needed to survive in order to give you this vital information. We're uplifting the community.
Yeah.
You know how many artists and producers we've lifted up? It's crazy. The Frankenstein.
It's our moral responsibility.
Your laptop froze for a second, man. My bad.
I want to say, let me plug this this laptop in because sometimes when the battery low, it does it.
Okay. It was like, it froze right at the perfect spot.
Yeah, I got a lot of apps running right now. I need to close down anyway.
Yeah. Oh, man. But models will come over to chill. That's enough. Here's the thing with models. I want to make this clear because I don't want girls, you know, my future relationship life to get it twisted. I'm with the models for business purpose only. There's no side stuff going on with these models. It's for business. I'm trying to make money with the models. I'm making them money. That's it. It comes down to that. That's it.
Here's what I was going to say about not the models. I'm going to leave that alone. okay. Because I ain't about to ruin no future relationships for you. We as a society, this is not just producers and rappers. We have this stigma that money is a bad thing. And because of that stigma, it starts to bleed over in our philosophies of people who sell us things, right? The same people who say things like FL Studio should be free, right? Not taking into consideration the man hours that it takes to create something that is so convenient for all of us to create music. Right. They say things like water should be free, right? they have folks who are just like, I should never have to pay for things like that because it's from the nature. Everybody has their feelings about that. And that all stems from, I think, a mentality that money is a bad thing. Asking to be paid for your work is a bad thing. And not bad in the sense that that's not what people do, but bad in the sense that, you know, what if I can't afford it? Like, why you can't look out for me? Are you too good? You know, that is dangerous. That's dangerous to your own growth if you start to feel that way. And that was probably the hardest thing for me to unlock and change in my own mind, that selling my products was a bad thing because certain people couldn't afford it. That's the most ridiculous thing in the world. But here's the thing about it. Not only do you need to sell your products and sell your information, sell your value, money is an echo of the value that you give. That's one. Second, Grant Cardone says this, it is your moral, not just your financial, it is your moral obligation to take care of yourself, and if you have a family, your family as well. Mm-hmm. So you're actually doing something immoral by not selling your products. If you're spending time that you could have been spending with family or could have been spending at a job and you're spending it on your craft, it is almost immoral for you to put that out there. And it is your moral obligation to generate income, to take care of your family. And then also, too, like Game said, for the survival and really for the growth of an industry that is here to help, we have to sell these products. Right. It would be great if it was some altruist universe where we could give free products and all of our needs were taken care of. That would be so amazing, because then it wouldn't be so many like awkward conversations with people who are not trying to pay. But in this world, in this life, in this real life, it is your moral obligation to generate income. When I saw it from that perspective, I stopped looking at money as such an evil thing. Money is not evil. Money is green pieces of paper. The value that we give to it, the story we tell about it. You know, money is not evil. It's the magnifying glass to who we truly are. Mm-hmm. And it's the best way that I can put it.
In my weird, twisted world, you know, money represents value, and the exchange of value is what creates reality. So I'll leave it at that. Here's one thing: is that nothing's free. Like, not even school's not free. The school that the public school you go to is paid by what? Taxpayers. The college you go to is paid by who? Federal loans, that's paid by you eventually to pay the programmers deserve it for sure. What do you mean? Oh, the support. Yeah, Stefan is heavy in tech, and he was saying that he's heavy in coding, so he knows the time hours that go into coding. You're wasting your life. You're putting your survival at risk to help somebody else. Yep. You should naturally want to return their survival. It's just you're keeping each other alive.
Keep the ecosystem going.
But here's another caveat that people don't think about, is that nothing's free. You know, education in grammar school is not free. College is not free. Even when you go to work for somebody and you're learning from that job, it's not free. They're making money off of you. Like, they'll pay you $10 an hour, but they're making 40 or 400, whatever their variable is. It's costing you money to go to a company and work sometimes and learn from them. Even internships cost you time. Some internships don't even pay. So knowledge is never free. It's never been free. And the reason it's not free is because you're creating somebody who can create more value over time. And I can't really explain leadership in like 2 seconds, but you're giving somebody else a career. That's not free. You know, if I'm giving you a career and you're making tons of money off of stuff I'm teaching you, you know, it's just like put it this way, any government. Does Facebook give secrets over to Microsoft? Is that knowledge free? No, it will never be free. Will our American government ever give knowledge to Russia so they can go build the spaceships like SpaceX and all these things? Will Tesla ever give knowledge over to whoever?
Hyundai.
Yeah, that's never happening. And I think we get it so twisted because people just, it's the way we're built. I'm going to stop ranting. But here's some more questions that are good. I'm going backwards. So IX Production says, that's too new. Sorry, let me go backwards. Bernison Francisco says, what can I do if I'm trying to sell my beats, but the people around me don't seem to want to buy it? So I think we hinted at this earlier.
Right.
The people around him don't want to buy it. So he's talking to the wrong audience. That's just the bottom line.
Yeah, you can only sell if you live in a community full of people with no arms, you can only sell basketballs for so long. You know, if people are not looking for your product, if they're not looking for it, you're looking in the wrong place, and you're trying to find abundance where abundance does not exist for your particular style or your particular business. What you have to do is first seek that abundance inside. First seek, what do I do so well that I can do it literally in my sleep? Then you go in and you work. You work your tail off. You work your tail off for about 2 or 3 months. You build up a catalog based upon the sounds that come to you the easiest that is more difficult for other people, because more than likely that is your calling. That is your sound. You may, just like every producer you talk to, you say, what is your style? Well, I do many different things. Every producer says that. But we're not specialists in every single one of those things. So my thing is this, find the thing that you do the easiest that is difficult for other people. That is your thing. If you can build up a catalog of about 50 beats, 60 beats in 3 or 4 months, and they're all your sound, you don't have to worry about the people around you who are buying it. You got to go create something somewhere else. That's where the online becomes your biggest friend. If you create some kind of energy online that is pushing in your direction, it's going to change you financially. It's going to change the way that you maneuver. And when people see a different energy in you locally, they'll address you in a different way. You're no longer just the guy struggling to get your beats out. Now, all of a sudden, you're the guy that's generating income, and they better get in on this. I'll tell you this. Mm-hmm. I used to have a theory that people in California did not like to lease beats. Why? Because my first 4 months, nobody locally would buy my beats, because they were like, I'm not about to lease a beat from you and see you at a show and then three other rappers lease the same beat. So it took me literally building my business in states that I'd never been, you know, from at that time I had never been to Florida, to countries like, you know, going to Germany, to, just different places in the US, Texas and places. I'm like, it took me building with these people before my local audience even gave a damn, before local rappers even say, you know what? Shoot, if that's the only way I can get beats from you, I got to go over here and do it then. Mm-hmm. So that's what I got to say is that you, if it's not happening for you locally, go somewhere else and get that respect online. You don't have to move. Go online and watch the way people change when you have all this energy circulating around you. People thought that when I decided that I didn't want to rap anymore and I only want to focus on production and my YouTube channel, they thought I fell off the face of the earth because I didn't go to any events anymore. Then I came back. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden they're looking at my Twitter and it's like 150 retweets, 150 likes. I'm not paying for these. I didn't ask these people to go follow me. They followed me from my YouTube naturally. And because of that, now the local people who are seeing it like, damn, when did you blow up? What did you do? Where are you big at? Mm-hmm. Don't worry about them. If they're not tapping in, they'll tap in later. Mm-hmm. You know, even if they're your haters, one day your haters will ask if you're hiring. Grant Cardone.
Hashtag. There's so many questions I'm trying to copy and paste over. Hold on 1 second. So I'm going to send you these questions. Halftime Beat says, if you can go back. Well, that's kind of broad. We're going to leave that for the end halftime because that's really broad. So these might not seem on topic right now, but Black Noise says, you can use DistroKid to help track royalties, right? From my knowledge, DistroKid only gets a certain amount of royalties. Like, it's kind of hard to understand the back end of, like, putting your music through the system, so to speak. Like, when you put it online, like SoundExchange or TuneCore, one of those things, they all collect, mm-hmm. like, separate things. Like, it's not like one site collects all the Just Do royalties. Because, again, it comes down to relationships. They have to know how to get the money. It's people involved. There's lawyers involved. They have to know who to talk to get their reports so that they can track. It's human activity. It's not like a computer. Now, some tools may be computerized, but there's people involved. So different companies have different people. So with DistroKid, I don't think they collect all your royalties. They only collect like a certain amount. If you look at TuneCore, they collect a little bit more, but even TuneCore doesn't collect all your quote unquote like monies from music. Then you have your PRO, like BMI or ASCAP, which collect your performance stuff, like the stuff that's offline, basically. So it's like you have to have a piece of each puzzle to make this one big thing. It's weird online. I don't know why it works that way. It has to do with copyright law, I guess. But that's my understanding of it right now. I would look into TuneCore. I know DistroKid has their own thing going, but just keep in mind that's more for the entrepreneur who wants to create their own kind of system. Like, it's not for the person who wants to be in the system. It's like for people who just want to put their stuff up on YouTube, get it monetized, put it on SoundCloud, do it themselves, versus like getting it into, does DistroKid get it into iTunes and all that? I assume.
Yeah, it gets it. It gets it in all the major distributors. DistroKid gets into also too. Something that if you're using DistroKid, that's an advantage of using it is that they have these things called teams. So if there's a songwriter that made the hook for your song, if you made the beat, and if there's a rapper that rapped over the verses, you can all be a part of the same team and determine the splits using the team feature. So that's another way that they kind of track royalties, and they split it up for you, so you don't have to even worry about that.
That's dope, because just like you know, the beat stores that allow you to split up revenues, I think that's perfect, because now it's not a jumbled mess when you have a bunch of people involved.
Yeah, man. And the thing about it is you gotta give these websites some chances to grow, because it's still a very young business. It's not even in its teenage, like the streaming generation is not even in its teenage years yet. Like, it's still a very new concept for some for these companies. So they're adjusting to it and seeing the way people's habits change, which they change very quickly now in listening to music. So they're trying to play catch up. But I think a lot of them are doing great work. I think DistroKid like changed the entire game, though, because they said $19.99 a year, upload as much music as you want to streaming websites, and we'll get it there faster than anybody else. They won. TuneCore, you got to wait. You know, you got to pay $29 every single album. I think like $9.99 per single or something like that. But you already took care of it with one yearly fee. And you get to take care of everybody who's involved in a record. That's money to me.
I think it has something to do with like international royalties, like international radio. It's like different pieces of the puzzle that might not even pertain to you. So it really just depends on people's situation. There's so many questions. Again, let me copy this one from Noah real quick.
I'm really digging this chat today, because I feel like folks are probably the most engaged that they've been in quite some time, because it seems like this might be a particular pain point for them to focus in on. So I just want to say that I appreciate all the questions that are coming through right now.
There's a lot of good questions, so I had to copy them over. So starting at the top, Mongo says from some time ago, broaden your horizons other than rappers. It's way more money in movies and TVs and commercials. How would you, not even saying that you have the facts or anybody has the facts. I think a lot of people speak from non-factual standpoints. Not even this comment, but I meant to mention that earlier. Like, the internet is drying up. What stats are you looking at? What facts? Show me the facts. Show me the research that says the internet is going down.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of like, people don't do their research.
It's a doomsday prophecy. But then also, too, when people say things like that, my question is, okay, so what's your next play? Because obviously you're trying to put out a certain narrative to put fear in people, because there's two reasons why people buy from you. Either you're giving them extreme pleasure or you're helping them to avoid extreme pain. So if somebody touches on your pain points and says, oh, man, ain't no money on the internet. Oh, my God. So what do I do next? Mm-hmm. If you don't provide the answers, then you have other motives. You have other things that you're trying to sell, which, I mean, no matter what industry you're in, those people exist. Mm-hmm. But you got to provide an alternative. What? Okay, so then if it's dried up, what's going on then? Ain't nothing dried up. The thing about it is you can't run the same plays you were running 5 years ago and think you're going to make the same money you made. That's in any industry. You got to evolve with it. Right. And the thing about it is it's a matter of if you want to evolve with it. Some people hate this beat leasing industry so much because they've been invested into it so much. They've made all the money in the world, but they're still not happy. Mm-hmm. Why? Because they have put out a reputation that other producers don't necessarily care for, right? For me, like, I know there's a lot of producers, and even within the online community, who don't care for my brand of inspiration, motivation. They don't care for my charismatic ways. They tell me my thumbnails. Like, one dude was like, we used to beat up faggots like you for smiling all the time. I didn't do nothing but smile on the thumbnail and put my thumb up. I smiled. Yeah. But that's the nature of certain producers online. But is that everybody? No. Right. And the fact that I continue to keep pushing forward, the fact that I continue to keep smiling It's creating a new dynamic in which I'm starting to see producers that I won't name them by names, but they're changing. And I'm seeing their channels changing. I'm seeing their thumbnails changing. I'm seeing them show more of their personality. I love that. I love it. I don't care if you have to copy me to do that. We producers got to be more personal. A lot of y'all got some of the most smart ass stuff to say online, but then we put a camera in your face. Your we need you to, you good now?
Yeah, every time you like go in, it's like the energy freezes. The screen something.
Basically what I was saying is that a lot of producers have this energy on the internet. The troll energy are like this aggressive energy. They don't keep the same energy when it comes to comes to real life. You meet them, you would never know they produce. They're not the same smart ass people they are online. And that's what I'm learning, is that we have to now get from behind the keyboard and turn into more charismatic individual. We have to grow into that, because our businesses survive off of us. You can't survive off of a logo. You can only do that for so long.
Yeah, I used to have that. Yeah, over time you gain that confidence. And I would say a lot, there's like this part of the producer community that's very focused on immediate gratification. You know, that two-step producer. We talked about this in the video I just published, which is they're worried about, okay, how do I bring this 100 views to go to my website? That's it. They think that's a business. I hate to tell you, that's the tip of the iceberg of running a real business. That's basically nothing. That's like beginners can do that. Anybody can, and I'm not bashing people specifically. I'm just saying anybody can set up a beat website and just be like, okay, this is it. You know, and all I got to do is just do this and this and send people from here to my Instagram to my beat page, and that's it. You know, and they don't understand the long term of business. And I think they think it's that way. So when they follow certain people who can't lead, you know, they get into this unfulfilled place, you know, because they're whatever. I don't know the whole thing.
You're hitting on the head. And I think the bigger thing of what you're saying too, in the way I perceive it, is as a producer, you got to be careful, even with us. Like I love the fact that there's so many people in here who are eager to get their questions answered. Research what we tell you. I think that's a good model for anybody that's a leader. Research what we tell you. Because nine times out of 10, you're going to find more than enough articles to back up what we're saying. Will there be people who feel the opposite? Sure. But I think that most of the times, you know, and it's funny because every time I do a consultation with a rapper or a producer, the first question I ask them, besides, you know, who are you, what do you do, is what is your number one goal? And I'm telling you, 95% of them struggle with that question, not because they don't know what they want, because they want so much and they can't focus on one thing. And that is the reason why you're having so many issues in your life, is that you want all these different things. I want a million plays on Instagram. I'm a million plays on SoundCloud. I kind of want to sell beats. I want to work with this artist. I want to be on the radio, but I don't want to be on the radio. I want to be on. It's just all these different things. If you were to focus in on one thing, the acronym that I remember from Focus is follow one course until success. Focus in on something, you know, master that, go in, and then create more opportunities because of that.
That's dope. Focus. Wait, what was it? Focus on one course?
Follow one course until success.
Follow one course until success. That's pretty dope. And like you said, people act out of two things. Well, mainly. High desire, or the act to avoid pain aversion. And this comes from the law of attraction. White hot desire. That means you have to desire something so much. Your affinity has to be so high, just like a chemical has to want to bond with another chemical so much that there's movement. And they come together to bond. And that's, you have to bond with your dream. You have to have so much a desire for your dream that you take action to begin moving. And the moment you start moving is the moment you create momentum. And when you move, there's cause and effect. That video is coming soon. But when you start moving, when you move, that's cause. And when you move, you create effect, which means for every up, there's a down. There's a counter action for every action you create. And so anyway, you have to have desires, what I wanted to say. So here's some good questions still. If you can go, okay. Again, that's very vague. I got to skip that one. How do I better find my audience? That's kind of a vague one. I don't want to eat up too much time on that one because we have like micro questions. How do I better find my audience? What's like a quick tip?
You got to figure out how music speaks to you first. And then you got to find like-minded individuals from there. You don't find your audience. You become something great that attracts these people. I think trying to find them is the wrong way to go about it. Don't worry about finding them. Be the best at what you do. Be the best at showing visibility. Marketing is literally, how can I tell my message the most clear to the people that need to hear it the most? That's all marketing is. So as you do that, figure that out and clearly convey that message the best you can, the best you can. And I'm telling you, you will attract the people that need to be there. Because if you go looking for people, you're going to hate the people you eventually go looking for, because you'll realize, I really didn't even want these people. I just wanted people, you know? So that's probably the quickest answer I have for that.
Yeah, as far as audience, just think of it as like real life. Like, I always pull up the metaphor of getting girls. Again, you don't talk to a church girl the same way you talk to a girl you find at a bar, like at a nightclub or strip. I'm just going to say strip club just because it's kind of like the opposite.
Yeah, that's polar opposite.
But you just don't talk to them the same way. Certain girls want edge. Certain girls want values. Carolina asks, how to continue making progress when you seem to lack in everything? When you seem to lack... Oh, you remember you spoke about focus on your strengths, not your weaknesses, I think?
Yes, right? Yes, and surrounding. Yes.
So I have a delegation example, but what do you have to say? Again, the question is how to continue making progress when you seem to lack in everything, meaning like how do you get motivation to push forward?
You're not going to appreciate the progress you're making fully if you are focusing still on the things you don't have. I think that's those are countering energies that'll put you in a place of confusion and probably sometimes make you not create anything at all. You can't worry about the things that you're weak at, because on a real philosophical level, let's get it even deeper than just answering this question. As we develop as human beings, you ever wonder why somebody will learn somebody who never touched music a day in their life will pick up the piano and all of a sudden they pick up the trumpet faster than somebody who started just with the trumpet? Or they pick up guitar faster than somebody? You may say, well, they know music theory. It's not always the truth. What happens is that you start to realize internally the way that you learn things. You have a habit. You have a certain ritual that you go through, a certain step-by-step process of how you learn things. For me, it's the same thing. For me, like when I started making beats, I learned on a PlayStation. I didn't open the manual up. Some people need to open the manual up. I'm the type, I get in there, get my hands dirty, mess something up, and then I ask the question online, okay, how do I fix this? Because I learned so much faster that way than reading a manual and then being like, oh, I can't wait to get to that chapter 2. Oh, I can't wait to get to that chapter 3. Oh, I can't do things in that order. For me, I have to get my hands dirty, do it, mess it up, and then say, okay, how do I fix this? Right? Because that works for me. When you understand the way that you learn, no matter what you're learning, no matter what you're trying to progress at, you'll use the same muscles and the same techniques. Now, that's on a philosophical level, but when it comes to actually progressing at something, you're seeing other, don't focus on the things that you're not growing at, because that's going to hinder the strength that you do have. Whatever you're progressing at, it's probably growing muscle, but at a very slow rate because you're still focused on the things you're weak at. So if, for instance, for me, I was terrible at making chord progressions and melodies and everything except for the drums. Drums, I murdered. So I kept improving my drums. I got my drums so amazing that piano players wanted to play with me because their drums didn't smack. So now that law of attraction, now I'm in a situation where my drums are so strong, they are garnering the attention of people who play the piano keys like efficiently. They're just as good on the piano as I am with my drums. And so that's what I did. And then in the midst of that, I learned the way that I learned, and I used my tools to figure out, okay, what are some easy ways to build chord progressions? Oh, by the way, there's this guy named BusyWorksBeats.com that has these music theory in a day courses. Maybe I should look into that. Oh, snaps. All of a sudden, here I am playing a little bit more fluidly than I ever played before because I took the course. And that's what I'm saying, is that it starts with strengthening your strengths. Don't worry about strengthening your weaknesses. Everybody else around you is going to tell you to strengthen your weaknesses, and they have no control over their own strengths or weaknesses. You can't listen to them. Focus on the things that you have right now that are working for you. Focus on your strengths. Beef that up. Make that on steroids. Everything else will start to adjust around it. Now those weaknesses won't matter as much because your muscle is so strong and your strength, it doesn't matter. Like, think about Sylvester Stallone and Arnold Schwarzenegger. You don't want to see them in a romantic movie about a love between a 7-footer and a 5-foot woman. You want to see them in action films. So what did Arnold Schwarzenegger do? He did a million Terminators. What did Sylvester Stallone do? First he did porn, and then eventually he did Rocky. He's been playing Rocky every single movie he's in. That's what it is. I know you're from Philadelphia, so that's probably even extra funny. But he's been playing Rocky in every freaking movie. So the thing about it is even the most elites in acting do the same thing. You're no different. You want to become elite in your production, find that thing you do better than anybody else. Mm-hmm. For some rappers, it's their ad-libs. That's all they got. Beef that up. Evolve that. Show us something different. And then from there, you'll attract people that can bring, that can suffice for this, the weaknesses that you have. But don't go trying to strengthen your weaknesses. It's your weakness. It's not your strength.
Yeah. I have a video coming soon about time management. About that specifically, focus on your highest value thing and surround yourself with people who are better at that thing. And, you know, you, at the end of the day, you make more money when you delegate, okay? You'll see that video coming soon, whether it's today or tomorrow. She also says, but it's so hard to keep moving to a place you don't know exactly where it is. And this is where Napoleon Hill's philosophies usually get put implemented. And that's, you have to have a crystal clear desire, which means this is why people have dream boards. They want to visually see, okay, this is the house I want. Now I can mm-hmm. see it. I don't have to like use my imagination to a crazy degree, because sometimes it's hard to really like imagine every little thing about something and keep it in front of you, keep it in front of your imagination, because that's a skill. It's a muscle you have to build. Try a dream board. Again, you have to know exactly what you want. A lot of people just have no idea what the heck they want, and they're always going to be lost because people are trying to find themselves, and they actually end up losing themselves trying to find themselves. So that's why we have so many lost people. Here's something I learned from Joe Vitale. Shout out to Taylor for putting me on to Joe Vitale again. I kind of brushed him over. He's from the Secret series, but he teamed up with this guy and he created a technique, a Hawaiian doctor. It's called the Pono Ono Ono, I think. And the phrase is, I love you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, thank you. So that's supposed to, we talked about gratefulness.
Right.
Or thankfulness, whatever, to accept what you already have. Like a lot of people are not, they don't see what they already have. Mm-hmm. And they're not willing to receive. So these four phrases, I love you means you're willing to exchange. I'm sorry means you surrender, which means you're willing to receive. Please forgive me is a forward action of telling that other side of the equation. Once you understand this in a little bit, when I release the video, the other side of the equation, please forgive me means please allow you to receive. Please allow me to give. Thank you means, again, thank you for that exchange. So you're restarting the engine of exchange of energy. You'll understand that in the next couple of videos I put out. But that's a technique from a high level teaching. There's so many questions. You want to kind of like rush through these because we have about how many minutes? We have about 30 minutes, but these questions are like dense. Can we kind of rush through these like a fire?
Sure, like sure, sure, fire sure.
Sin Trex says, how should I approach a preview for a drum kit? I guess he means, what do you think he means? How can I approach a preview for a drum kit? I don't know what that means.
Approach a preview? I mean, if you're putting out a drum kit, I think simply demonstrating it through an MPC is great, or demonstrating it through your program, doing like a cookup, 5 minute, 10 minute cookup with your drums. I think that doing a demo track that uses the majority of your drums in it, like on SoundCloud as a preview was great for that. For a drum kit I put out. Yeah, he said for a drum kit he put out. So for a drum kit you put out, those three ideas should get you on your way. You just got to find a way to show people how easy it is to insert your drums and what it can do for their drums. Mm-hmm. There's a million and one drum kits. What is special about yours? You can answer that question more than three or four times, you should be doing pretty well.
Mm-hmm. And please don't be that guy who begs people to review their drum kit for nothing. No, just don't, hell do that.
No, don't do that.
Just don't do that. Nobody's going to want something that's not wanted already. So just don't even waste your time.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm about to say, if anything, align yourself strategically with people that are in your corner that may have a bigger following than you. Don't tell them to review it. If they have a, you just give them the kit and say, I want to gift this to you. You know, I've been really working to try to make producers' workflows even easier. It would be great if you had access to it. You never know what somebody wants to do with it. You never know if they want to promote it on their social media. Just don't go looking for something. When you're giving somebody, when you're doing a favor for somebody, make it a real favor. Don't make it a, like I have people that, sometimes I don't even respond back to people in my Instagram, and you know, people are like, "Oh, why, Curtis, it's the direct opposite of who you are. Why are you like that?" Because the quality of conversations that I have, and I give people opportunities all the time, is, "Yo, Kurt, man, yo, that post is so inspirational. Appreciate it, brother. Thank you for watching. Hey, by the way, man, I got this song here on SoundCloud. I think you should check it out." And it becomes white noise because everybody is doing that. Not everybody, but the majority of people that send me messages are doing that. They're thinking about them. They're not saying like, they're not thinking about the person that they're sending a message to. They're thinking like, "All right, I'm gonna get him to respond back to me. Then I'm a hard sell on him." You can't. That's not the way we build relationships up. You can't do that.
Yeah. If anything, find somebody who, like you said, lacks that, whose weakness it is in the drum category. Maybe they're doing something else. Be complimentary. Here's something on Facebook. A lot of people were dropping gems, and I just realized Facebook just refreshed the chat. So here are the gems from Facebook. These are kind of late, but it says from Indigo. It says, "Turn your dreams into reality. Imagine, then speak it into existence and go out with actions, with good intentions. Find that place inside yourself where nothing is impossible." So that's the allness, where all things are possible. I'll get into that video a little bit. Stefan, shout out to Stefan. He says, "Winning looks a lot like losing until you win." I wonder who that quote is from. Winning looks a lot like losing until you win. That's really how marketing works. A lot of people think marketing is just doing this magic thing and then it just magically giving you stuff. Like, marketing is really testing a bunch of stuff, seeing what doesn't work, and then you scale up what actually works. So you're failing at all the other stuff. You find out what works, and then you scale it up. Right. Stefan also said, "Failure is generally required in order to obtain success." Boy, you're talking to two people who failed on levels that you can't even imagine.
Man.
Me and Curtis King, good Lord.
Failures, I would never wish even on my worst enemies. Oh, Lord.
Yeah. The amount of the comment Facebook deleted a comment, I think. But yeah, to get to like these higher up, why am I talking like I'm an elitist? These upper echelons. I'm glad I'm stumbled over that word. To get to these levels of success, you know, to have over 70 million views, and I deleted 4 million willingly because they're old and I don't need them. I just deleted 4 million views. They're gone. Whatever. You know, to inspire over 500, like a half a million people around the world, to create careers, to give people hope again, to love with, to find their true passion. That's the stuff that lifts us up. And like, to get to that point, we had to die. Like, we literally had to die emotionally many times. And, you know, it's almost like, you know, what Christ goes through. If you're a Christian or you understand that story, like, you have to be crucified as far as your emotional self. You have to die and you have to sacrifice yourself to get to where you want to be. And we probably die every day, you know, in our business.
You got it. But I mean, I feel like the death is a natural process. It has to happen. Some parts of you need to die for other things to grow. What's not growing is dying, and what's dying is not growing. So you got to find ways to kill off bad habits. You got to find ways to kill off these things that are holding you back. And sometimes we as creatives get in our heads, and I find myself sometimes getting there too. I'm not always ultra positive. There's days where I just feel like shit, but the thing that I don't do that I used to do, I don't harp on it for any longer than 5 to 10 minutes. I refuse. So I believe there's a book called The 5-Minute Rule. I've never read it, but I understood the concept of, we're either going to do something about it or we're not going to keep complaining about it. Because if we keep complaining about it, there's nothing we can do about it. Obviously we would have done something if there was something we could do about it. Right. Mm-hmm. So I think that sometimes life, especially for me, you know, gang, we talked off the air some of the stuff that's happened in the last year. That stuff had to happen to completely get me out of my head and make me never be as indecisive as I once was. I'm so sure about every single move that I make, even if somewhere inside of me I don't know what it's going to happen, I'm sure about what I'm getting ready to do. And if it's a failure, then I'm sure that I took an L, but I'm sure I'm going to pick my ass up and do it again. I'm so sure about things. I look at my son in the face and I'm so sure. I look at my wife. I am so sure what we got to do. Even right now, like, we're planning to move to a home that, you know, right now I'm looking at, like, based upon the money I make right now, I don't know how possible that is, you know, in 6 months. Doesn't matter. I'm working as if I'm going to get something that's double that. The 10X rule. I got to 10X that. When I 10X that and I go in, the worst that can happen is I fall short of a goal that wasn't even mine to begin with.
Right.
You know, so 10x it. And I think that, and basically what I want to say is that I think that life sometimes has to kick you in the ass before you decide to go another direction. Mm-hmm. And we doubt ourselves. We complain. We're fearful. We're scared. Sometimes life has to really scare us before we're like, that was nothing that I was scared of. Mm.
This is kind of a relative question. Halftime says, Busy Works Beats or Curtis King, what seemed to be one of the hardest things to learn, or what caused your problems at the beginning, if anything? So the hardest lesson, I guess, we've learned. They could be from anything that you think propelled you to get to where you are. I would start off with saying that the hardest thing I've learned is that... That's a hard question. It's harder than I thought.
I got it. I got it.
Hardest thing I've learned.
In order to accomplish whatever I want to accomplish, I have to give first. Even when I don't have anything, I have something to give. Hmm. It took me at my lowest financial point. After I actually started making money with the beat leasing business, I reached another low because I spent too much money. I didn't change that mindset. I had the mindset that this money's not going to last long because that's all I came up with for the first 28 years of my life, 26 years of my life. And so I still had to rid myself of that mentality. So the most difficult thing I had to understand is that literally whatever dream you have, whatever goal, be it materialistic, whatever it is you want to get accomplished, it has to come at the service of other people. You have to serve the people. You have to give value, and value is more than just what I do, my music. It's more than that. I got to find ways to share value to get to where I ultimately want to get to, right? The way that the quickest route to your dreams is to help others on the route towards theirs. It's a hard concept when you're like, well, what can I offer? I'm still up and coming. What can I possibly give advice to? You have something that's of value to give somebody. Mm-hmm. If you're 16 and you're just making beats, if you're a month in, guess what? The 14-year-old that's in your house, maybe your little brother or sister who wants to make beats, you are producer God to them because they don't know anything. And they see you in there cooking. They look at you with wide eyes like, man, one day I want to make beats like my older brother. You can teach them. Right. That can go from you teaching them to you now teaching a classroom full of these 14-year-olds who want to learn how to make beats. Now you can charge money for this because of your experience and your learning of this. Because the thing about it is, it's not so much that Game or I can give that student a better teaching. Obviously, we know more about the program than a 16-year-old who's been doing it for 2 months. Doesn't matter. Your way of explaining things is probably a lot more clear to the 14-year-old than how I explain things to them. I'm so far removed from what it is, the mindset of a 14-year-old. A 16-year-old has a better understanding because they're only 2 years out. I don't want to say how many years I am from being 14, but that's the thing about it. You have your own intrinsic value to these people.
Yeah.
So you got to find ways to stop making excuses. I don't have anything to give a value. So all you got to do is consume. You're not going to get anywhere. Just consume, 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 consume. You got to give something to get to where you want to get to. Mm. And I mean, if you're down to your last dollar, you can give 10 cents to somebody who's homeless, right? But you got to give with a giving heart. You got to understand what giving is. You got to understand what gratitude is. You master gratitude. That was the most difficult thing for me because I thought I was already grateful. I wasn't, because I was complaining about the things I didn't have. That's not gratefulness. Mm-hmm. So that's the most difficult for me, is understanding the power of value, giving, and gratefulness.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. I would say the hardest lesson, this is probably like top five, probably not the hardest. I would say, shoot, I had it in my head and I forgot. But let me think, because when I lose a thought, like something random has to trigger it. So I have to go to the next question. I apologize.
Sorry. Black, can I shoot this one off real quick?
This is the topic. Yeah, go ahead.
Black Noise said, what can we give to rappers? If you are a producer that generates traffic for a living to your beat store, you're generating traffic to beats. If you have an Airbit player, I don't know about BeatStars, but if you have an Airbit player, open up another tab and start uploading the songs that rappers have rapped over and make your own like playlists. Okay? Start there. Start sharing some of this traffic with people who are investing into you. You know, because that way they can see what everybody else sounds like. They can also see like you know, how well their songs do in front of your audience. And also, too, you don't have rappers as just your fans. Other producers are your fans. You could even give an opportunity for this rapper now to have a more balanced album because they're buying from you, buying from somebody else. That person sees that. You could even set up an affiliate marketing program, but that's later down the line. What can you give rappers? You can give them marketing advice, since I feel like, in general, it feels producers are a lot more ahead of the curve in terms of being business savvy or even being internet savvy than a lot of rappers are. Teach them the way, right? Make videos. Like, I started off making videos. I didn't just say, hey, music producers. I said rappers and producers. This is Curtis King of CurtisKingBeats.com. Here's the topic I want to talk about, because I understood how important that relationship bond is. So think about the things that you have learned. Like, even when, like, when SoundCloud's getting ready to shut down, I sent an email to all my customers, didn't sell them anything. I said, SoundCloud might be getting ready to shut down. You might want to get your music off the website. Here's some alternatives. I gave them value. So many things you can do to give. I'm just giving you a few examples. Yeah. So many things to give people, man.
The one you said was perfect, which is create a reward system. So if they're doing business with you and they know friends who are going to do business with you, they can get rewarded for doing that. And you said something else before that, but think on those lines. It was the bringing traffic to them.
Right. Because a lot of them are buying your beats for $30, $50. And it's crazy because people say things like industry producers talk bad about leasing producers. Like, you're only selling your beats for $30 and $50. First of all, you're not selling the complete rights. You're selling a lease. Mm-hmm. Second of all, the majority of these rappers that are buying these beats are not making back that income that they initially invested. Now, some of that has to do with their business, not being business savvy, not promoting the music long enough, but they're not making that money back. So as a business model, it doesn't make sense if you're not providing them more value than just the beat. Because at some point in time, even if they want to keep rapping, they can't afford to buy your beats anymore, even at $30, because they're not making that money back. They're just funneling money and it's just going out the other end.
Yeah, that's why we give so much stuff away for free. We want you to make money off this stuff and apply it so that you can actually have resources to reinvest back in the products. We want you to make money. You should be making money with the advice we give you. That's the whole point. Mm-hmm. Anyway, one of the hardest lessons I learned is how to weed out the wrong people. That's like really a difficult thing because I'm so acceptable to certain people. But weeding out people and the power of association, those are the hardest lessons I've found in the last couple of years, because it gets difficult, man. Like, when you start scaling up, it's a whole different thing. Like, you have to multiply yourself over and over and over again. And it can get crazy. So here are some questions again. Mano says, hey, game, is going to a music school like Berkeley or UBC good? Can I just learn everything online? I'd say for music school, The main thing about music school, physical school, is like learning an instrument. Like, if you want to learn the violin and be in like an orchestra, of course music school makes sense, because you have to learn from a teacher. Now, I don't know, I've never really sat and like learned an instrument hardcore to the level of mastery, like a guitar. But in that case, I would think I would need a guitar mentor who can physically show me how to put my finger on the whatever, you know, the neck or whatever. That's little stuff you might have to learn from like a physical instructor. The stuff we teach, music business, the modern music industry, music theory, you know, mixing, mastering, post-production, pre-production, composition, that stuff you can learn online. Like, I didn't go to music school. Did you go to music school?
I almost did, because my mom and my dad were like, you better do something. You're not going to be just sitting around the house after high school. Mm-hmm. So that was their compromise. You know, well, you got to go somewhere. So I remember me and my mom, because my mom, if you know anything about my mom has played piano for over 38 years. She has had the opportunity. She could have went on tour with Bootsy Collins, but her parents wasn't having it. She had the opportunities to, she could have went to Grambling to go play in their music department. My mom knows music. So she went with me to my first tour of some of these, like MI Institute and this at Los Angeles Audio Recording School. And we walked in there and it looked cool. It was pretty cool. But every question that I asked them specifically about, okay, but how do I generate income after this? They were telling me I had to do things that I didn't want to have a passion for. I didn't want to be an audio engineer. Like, I didn't want to a mixed vocals. I didn't have a passion for that. But they were like, yeah, we have a program where if you engineer here, you'll automatically be interning at a studio that you'll be making money at. I'm like, I don't want to do that. I want to rap and make beats. Oh, well, there's some things you can learn here. Like, you know, like I give an example. I give an example of somebody who's very similar to sometimes these schools. DeVry. I'm pretty sure you heard of DeVry Institute. Mm-hmm. Now, this is not to rag on DeVry, because DeVry is really one of the greatest schools for, you know, for trying to get into like the tech world, or, you know, at least it was at the time that I was thinking about going.
Yeah.
One of the instructors came to my class and was trying to recruit people to DeVry. And I said, do you have anything there for people who want to make music or be music producers? He said, well, we have a department where you can make polyphonic ringtones. So you could be making that for like, you know, making six figures doing that. What happened to polyphonic ringtones?
Ooh.
Game?
Yeah, I don't even know if they allow you to install them on your iPhones anymore.
I'm talking about back in the day where it was like, almost like the game in 50 Cent. This is how.
Oh, like the MIDI version. Oh no.
Exactly. No. MIDI version for the cell phone. He tried to sell me on that, and it was going to cost me $60,000 for my first semester.
For the first semester.
So here's what I'm saying is that these schools are great, but a lot of them need you to have a huge down payment because they don't get the same support system that the traditional schools get, the government funded schools. They don't get that same support. So I think for MI at the time, their entry fee was you have to buy a new laptop. Mm-hmm. We have laptops on board, but you have to buy one of our laptops as sort of your entry fee. And once you get in here, then we can, you know, give you all the stuff that you need. But honestly, I don't know. Like I wouldn't suggest going if you have specific goals. If you want to just go in and network and find a way to get a foot in the door, it's a great place to go. It's great to meet friends and network. But I got a buddy right now who he put that degree on his wall and he's still engineering out of his room.
Yeah.
Everything is different for everybody.
It really is. Like somebody could say, you know, because I think Cynthia DeG said, I have a buddy who went to Full Sail for music production and he is now the owner of a sign spinning company. But just because you went to school for something doesn't mean in reality it's going to be that way. And that's the kind of myth we're taught as high schoolers, because we don't know. We really don't know the real world until we're in it. Like we think because we're going to school for biology, we have to be in the medical field or like in biology stuff. You don't. It's not how it works. Like for me, I studied biology. It's the study of life. I took out wisdom from biology, like the Fibonacci sequence I was telling Isabella about. She took a picture of a flower that had the Fibonacci sequence on it. And I said, that's the Fibonacci sequence. We learn that from biology, and you can apply that to business. You can apply it to beauty. You can apply it to music. You learn a lot of stuff that you can apply elsewhere. So like you learn how the systems of the body work. You'll see this in the videos coming soon, how the cells work, you know, affinity, all those things, polarity. You'll see how that works in the body, and then you apply it to your business, how to get people to either avoid extreme pain or get to their extreme desires. It's literally illustrated by your body already, just studying the systems of your body. So just because you went to school for something doesn't mean you're going to end up doing that thing. So do I discredit school? No. You do learn how to read, write, and socially interact. But,
right.
I mean, skills change. Are you just getting a general education? Or are you getting applicable skills? That's a big question. But that's like a whole conversation. It takes too much time to talk about that.
I just know that if I had to do this all over again, if I was starting in 2018... and I saw the amount of information that's available just on your website, your YouTube. If I met a Curtis King, if I met, you know, some of these other developers, the superstar O's and other folks that are out here, I wouldn't even bash an eye at school. I wouldn't even think twice about school. I would actually tell my dad, I'm not going to school. My school is YouTube right now. I'm going to generate income because I am efficient at what I do. There's proof of that. People want to invest in what I'm doing. I'm generating income today. I'm not wasting a minute inside of class. No way, no way in hell. That's me though. That's me. You got to figure out what works for you. But I knew that when I came out of high school, I said, I want to make money through my music and then I want to grow it. But I didn't do anything about it, right? I literally just kept working at Quiznos for 4 years. And in the midst of that, I was, you know, getting paychecks, literally to just pay to just make music more, you know? But the growth happened when I left that job. And so I suggest the same thing to you, is that look at what you actually want to get accomplished. You don't have to go through 4 years of schooling to learn music theory, right? To be a master at it, sure. But to learn it, there's courses out here ready for you, right? Sure. To put your own beat store together, there's no school for that. There's an online course for that. Like, you really figure out what your actual goal is, and it'll eliminate a lot of things that people tell you you need to do. You don't need to do a whole lot of the stuff people suggest.
What up, Iran? I guess Ali's from Iran. Awesome. Yeah, I was going to say the modern world. Darn, I had a quick little tidbit, and I always forget when I start talking about something else. Oh, I hate when thoughts leave my mind. That's like the worst feeling. God. What did you say at the tail end, please? Because I hope that triggers something.
School. Yeah, okay, school, and we're talking about...
Freak. What was it?
Basically saying how you got to take it with a grain of salt. You can't... When you know what you want, you eliminate a lot of the things that that people are telling you need to do.
Here it is. I'm sorry. I always lose thoughts. It drives me nuts. The funniest part is that I wanted to read books way more when I got out of school than when I was in school. What is school? They teach you to read books you're not interested in. They force you to do electives that you could care less about. They require you to take courses that you're not even going to apply in your real life. That school is a big wash. But again, it's vital you go to certain schools for different reasons in the job markets and all this. So there's really a yin and the yang to all this nonsense. Here's some more questions. Ruggish. M. Ruggish says, I get a free drum pack on many websites and make beats and save it and turn off the laptop and next day try to find another and make beats. What is my life? Oh, he's saying like he's on the search for so many sounds. We all go through that stage though. I feel like we all go through the acquisition phase because we want to know what stuff sounds like. What does a violin sound like? What does a cello sound like? I have to get the sound of a cello to know what it sounds like. So I think we're all trying to like get an education through finding all these things and then finding out what we don't want.
I think you hit that on the head for sure.
Because remember you did the whole anti-piracy video, like we have to get rid of the stuff that like we have this curiosity thing as producers. And we naturally want to grab all the plugins. It's just a natural thing.
We're massive consumers. Even stuff we never have a plan. Like it's crazy. Like as I'm buying stuff, I'm already seeing myself not using it as much as I thought I would. And it's almost like, man, why would I go through all the trouble of putting in, you know, freaking keygens and all of the stuff that you got to do when you go that route, when it's like I pay for it and I don't even really use it. It's not even worth doing it the other route. Like now I'm like, I can see even when I put my money behind it, this is something I am not necessarily going to do anything with. So I'm glad that I'm putting my money behind some of this stuff. Like even now it's funny. I started using, is it Silent or Silent? I always mess that up.
I guess it's how you like to say it. I think it's Silent because it's like silence, but it's like silent.
Yeah.
But people say,
okay, that makes more sense. Silent. I use that religiously. And somebody told me, man, you'll love Serum. And I got Serum, didn't like the stock sounds. And I almost made a video where I was like, Serum's overrated. And then I started getting more sounds from Splice and using it within Serum. And I was like, yo, this is powerful. Oh my Lord. Like this is really powerful. And so, I started putting that in there and started using like these sounds that I felt like Kanye was using on a lot of his newest beats or newest productions. And then I found a whole nother energy in me making music. So it's been a amazing feeling to take chances on that stuff, but you don't need all the things everybody says you need. Like you don't need Omnisphere. Would it be great to have an extra $400 for Omnisphere? Hell yes. You don't need Omnisphere. Stop letting people convince you that you need that because they love only 10% of the sounds in there. 10%. I have yet to meet anybody who has used more than, I mean, maybe that's game, but I've yet to meet anybody who's used more than 30% of the instruments actually on there, counting the combination sounds, and can tell you, oh man, yeah, this, you need every sound on this one. And it's like everything they tell me, like they say, you need choir sounds, they're so authentic. Okay, I got Olympus. Oh, well, that's cool, but like, it doesn't sound like this.
Oh, no.
There's always something else you can get. So if you're early in your production career, yeah, definitely be inquisitive, ask questions, watch reviews on videos. That's one thing I didn't do in the beginning and I wish I would have did. Watch people's reviews and watch preset reviews of how it sounds. So before you go actually putting your money into it, you see if it's something that applies to what you actually like in your own ears. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Don't just go there spending a bunch of money stupidly, because I could have saw myself doing that if I listened to the guy at Guitar Center who's like, oh man, nah, what you need is this $900 microphone to rap over. And then you need Pro Tools. You need Pro Tools, a double XXL, and then you need this MIDI keyboard. You ain't gonna use most of the sounds on there, but you need this one because it's big and it lights up. You need this. And I got a tattoo of a piano on my arm, so that means I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, man.
And a lanyard. Yeah, no, you don't need that shit.
Somebody was asking, where do you get equipment? And I was saying that, he said Sweetwater or Amazon. I said, Curtis King has an Amazon link, right? You still have it?
Yeah, I got the, it's the product page. So let me see if I can find that. And actually, I got to take a call right now.
Okay. Well, in the meantime, shout out to Nicole Nix, my secret project. She just released this video. I don't know what this sounds like, so I turn the volume up.
Right now.
Oh, that's you. Wait, hold on.
I was playing
YouTube, my bad. Shout out to Nicole Nix. You already know who Taylor is. What is this? ASAP Rocky remake, Praise the Lord. So it just shows people can learn. I'm glad she put this up because that's how I learned in the beginning. What did I remake? Oh, I remade Tom Ford by Jay-Z. Remember that beat?
That was so clean. Yeah, your remake was so clean. I was like, did he sample something from there?
I did, actually. I did sample the percussion. I found out Sound Oracle made it, so it made my conscience clean. But at one part, I couldn't create the percussion. It was like impossible to create it. I had to loop it. But the rest, like the arpeggio and the 808s. But I learned Timbaland style stuff by remaking that beat. I never would have thought to do a triplet. What was it? Like 64th speed triplet on an arpeggio. I never would have thought to do that. Like I learned that remaking that. Huh?
That's crazy. I just said wow. That's
in the beginning you remake. So I think you were talking about this earlier, the difference between copying and like finding your own style.
Copying and emulating. Yeah.
Yeah, like stealing versus, like, what is it? Great artist steal or whatever, copy, something, whatever. It just means that you take certain things. Like, if you like Curtis King's hat and you want to create your own style, you're like, okay, I like his hat. Okay, I like Game's shirt. Okay, I like Sound Oracle's shoes. Let me figure out an outfit where I put the hat together with his shirt and his shoes and figure out a new combination. Wait, you sent me a link? Okay, let me see.
Yeah, that's to the Amazon page.
Oh, I'm going to pull it up on my screen. There we go. Hold on one sec. I'm going to switch screens. So Curtis King created a whole pre-made, how do I switch screens? Give me 2 seconds.
Share your desktop.
There we go. Boom. OBS all in the way. But we got Curtis King. So he listed his equipment so that you don't have to spend time thinking. You're like, okay, he has this. It works. That's the result he gets. I know it gets that result. This is the work. These are the working components. What is this right here? A video card?
Yeah, so that's a RAM card, actually.
Oh, RAM
card. Which one are you talking about? The 64 gigabytes?
It says 500 gigabytes. Oh, no, internal SSD. Okay.
Yeah, so that's the upgrades that I made to my laptop. People want to know the exact specs of my laptop and how I'm able to handle so many contact libraries. That page has everything that I use, from my cameras, from my YouTube videos, the lighting, the filters, the LED lights. The books that I've read, like this is literally a one-stop shop for that.
Yeah. And he spent so many years trying to figure this out. This saves you instant years. Why would you waste time trying to figure out watching 1,000 videos? If he gives you the answer, this is basically like a cheat sheet, like the answers to a test. Like, why aren't you utilizing this? Oh, and your books, you said. Okay, cool. Oh, the Hydrate. I'm definitely grabbing that. Let me open that in a new link.
There it goes.
New tab, I mean.
So I can stop telling my friends, like, oh, man, I got this. You can just go and just see it. It's just right there. So
I'm glad I waited because I didn't know they sold it on Amazon. Okay, Gary V, we got Home Recording for Musicians, How to Rap. You actually read that book, How to Rap.
I love that book. Honestly, like, I looked at it from, like, a literature standpoint of a textbook for rapping. It was one of the greatest things I ever saw. I saw it. At first, I was laughing at it. And then I started reading it, and I was like, he actually breaks down by the synonym the way certain rap styles work and how they fall off of the snare and it makes it West Coast, how they fall short of the snare and it makes it East Coast. Like, there's so many techniques I learned in there. I was like, that's so dope. Just a better understanding of your craft.
And it just shows you, even though that person might not be Jay-Z writing the book, he still knows it because he's observing other people. Yeah. And he can pull out the things that maybe Jay-Z doesn't even know about himself. I had a question about a book. What do you like about The Tools of Titans? I found that book was very like broad. Like it had tips on health, tips on business. It was like very broad. It was like interviews, well, right?
It's interviews, but it's also like, it's like you got to think of it as a textbook, as short profiles for some of the most brilliant minds in the world. So the way I look at it is you don't read that book front to back, because it's a lot of pages. It's like a Harry Potter book. It's like Harry Potter book, two of them in one. But you don't read that book for that. You basically go and you got to go check certain profiles of people that you may admire, people that you're hearing about, and you basically get like a one profile sheet on all of their most important philosophies. He basically asks the same questions to all these multimillionaire billionaires, these thought leaders. Like he has another book called Tribe of Mentors that I still got to crack into, but that's the whole premise of it. Ask the same questions, see how they all have things in common. And then from there, you hope by association, it starts to shift your thinking in the way that you react to certain things. So very beneficial. I just look at it as a textbook. I go from time to time. Anytime I just want to get some easy reading.
So if I buy the Hydrate from this, you get credited for that?
Credited, and then I also get a percentage of that sale.
Awesome. I need to know it goes to you, not just to Amazon, because care less. I need to know.
It would be worth it because of the value to the producers and the rappers, but this makes it really worth it in knowing that all these programs that I'm using, you know, if I'm endorsing them on my channel, I have the opportunity to send you here, and now I'm getting sort of an affiliate fee from that. This is everything for me. So like, there's no more questions about, hey bro, what kind of headphones are those? Go to the page.
Yeah, and I'm shocked that they sell Omnisphere on this page. That's great. So you can get everything you need right here on his page. He created it, and the link. the YouTube won't let us post in their chat because they're just haters for every other website.
Sure.
But I'm gonna figure out how to post it in the post video thing. Wait, why is my, hold on a second. My Skype screen's looking odd. Oh, that's the chat. How do I get out of chat? I don't know how to use Skype. How to get out of chat. Okay, I just made it worse. Oh no, there we go. We're back. Okay, oh, I hit the wrong button. No, where are we at? What is going on? Can you see me?
Yeah.
Okay, you can see me. My chat's still open. Okay, go away. All right. I did something, man. I don't know what I just did. Shoot, I hope the chat... Okay, I'm sorry, the people watching. It switched the screen to full screen mode, and now it won't show you. Anyway, let's move to another question. I'll get that out the way in a second.
I'm glad we don't talk about nothing crazy in the chat between the two of us. I'm glad we don't say nothing crazy in there. In the chat, it's just pretty much like... checking in. All right, bro. Let's go live. Cool.
Oh, you're talking about in this chat on
Skype. In our chat.
Yeah. Nah. I don't know how to. Whatever.
I was going to say, you can put the link in the description, though. Can you? Or is that something that you got to do later?
Yeah, I don't think it changes until like we post it. But yeah, I can put it in the description. I'm going to do that. So anyway, the next question is... from Tamek, he says, what do you do when sales and YouTube/BeatStars views start drying up, even though you upload consistently? What do you do when sales and YouTube's, like your traffic, when your traffic dries up, what do you do?
I got to change a pattern. I got to mix up the signal that people are getting from me, because if something is going dry, that has to do with the way that I am presenting my business. People can't stop consuming things that are entertaining to them. Think about like Vlad TV, for instance. I cannot stand half of the videos I see up there, but they're so great at clickbait. They're so great at that they pull me in every single time. Tekashi said this about Chief Keef, and I go read it because I'm a hip hop head. I'm like a fan. Not even just. It's just hip hop, but just music, like music entertainment. I'm into that. Plus, I know it can be content for my YouTube, so I tap into it. Mm-hmm. Here's the thing about it. They make a business out of breaking the patterns of your promotions tab. Because a lot of the times, they don't even fall into my primary email. They fall into my promotions tab. They break the pattern. You got to break a pattern. So if you are only putting up YouTube links to your social media, if you're only putting up, you know, throwing out emails, if you're only uploading beats, you're thinking too linear. You're doing the same thing, so people are going to have the same response over and over again. You got to break the pattern. So say, for instance, on your Instagram, you have nothing but videos of your speakers playing your beats, or you got audio spectrums. Show your face and do something goofy just for no reason. Like, show yourself folding up laundry and saying, I hate laundry. How many of you hate laundry? This sucks. That's it. That's all I want to say. And just, you broke the pattern. Now all of a sudden people are like, the hell was that? Mm-hmm. Now they're looking for that kind of stuff. Maybe you take a hot take on a topic that everybody's talking about. You just got to break the monotony of what's going on. Sometimes it may be everybody's used to you being like, sup, y'all? I'm just about to show y'all this beat I'm working on. And then one day you get on video and you're like, ah, have y'all heard Kids See Ghosts? Oh my God, it's one of the greatest albums ever seen. Break the pattern. You don't like the result, break the pattern.
Yeah, so, man. Great marketers do that, man. Pattern interrupt. Gary Vee does this all the time. He says, hey, what's going on? F the mainstream industry. He always curses. Cursing is like the number one pattern interrupt because it's so like socially unacceptable to just randomly start spewing vulgarity. And that's what all the top marketers do to get your attention, to snap you out of, this is not your normal like guy in a suit talking to you. Okay, we're going to move your stocks and bonds over here to diversify your, right. Blah, blah, blah. They're like, this is the modern day. F what they're saying. Here's how Gary Vee talks. F what they're, I can't get his pitch, but he's like, F what they're saying. You have to diversify by putting it all into Twitter, whatever. So Gary Vee, shout out to Gary Vee. He uses pattern interrupt all the time. My bad. You got family? What up, Dom? We see you.
Yeah, I'll be trying to tell her she's not a prisoner in there just because we got 120 people watching. She ain't got to stay in the room.
Yeah, I mean, hey, you? The queen is arrived.
Oh, Don's asleep. Okay, let me shut up.
I don't know if I'm cutting into family time. I don't know your thing.
No, you good. I got to make a phone call. I was supposed to talk to somebody at 2, and I definitely...
Oh, my bad.
I kept forgetting about... I know we go over with these, so I'm not even tripping. I'm going to talk to them in a second, but... But yeah, man, I think it's a great, he's a great question. I really enjoyed today. It was a lot more, I think, a lot more subtle than it usually is. Mm. You are so creepy right now.
That one eyeball, he was tagger and credit.
I love you, though.
There you go. Dominique, the love of his life. Awesome, man. It's awesome to see, you know, people hanging in there. You know, a lot of people just give up. So.
Anyhow, man, that's my best friend, Doug. That's my best friend. Like, that's my real best friend. Like, she knows in such a short period of time. Like, people don't get it. Like, within the first month of me meeting her, like, we were together. And then, like, the second month, we were already working on that baby that came. And then within a year, like, within 9 months, you learn so much about somebody when you have to be around them all the time. She learned a lot about me. I learned about her. And we really sped the process up. But you got to do it with somebody that... in your heart, it's undeniable. That's my friend, dog. Like, that's my homie. Anything that goes on with her affects me. Mm-hmm. Vice versa. So now we're it's like, imagine two homies that get to, not dudes, but yeah. Imagine two homies that get to raise a kid. Not to say there's nothing wrong with it. Ain't nothing wrong with dudes. It. I'm saying like, I don't want you to think like she's like my, that's my dude. Yeah, that's my, no, that's my baby. That's my lady.
Anyway, shout out to Dom. One time, and Young Nas, he's asleep though for his last outro appearance. But anyway, this is Music Producer Conversations. We go into so much depth with Curtis King on the main screen up here. There's so many questions that I think I'm going to have to do a Q&A after this just to get through those questions, because like, I have a whole page of questions sitting there.
Or you could save them, and the next time we try to determine a topic, we got one of those.
You're like, or...
Or you could not, you know, we could, save some of these resources.
Luckily, I put it in Google Docs because rarely do I save stuff on this computer. Oh. Let me type in NPC topics. There we
dang
go.
Game. I see. We can't all go for like a family out in the woods, man. Because the way that is, you sound like you about to take all the wood and make one great fire for one night. And it's like, man, but what about tomorrow, man?
Oh, a bonfire? It's unnecessary.
I got all this wood. Let's make one great fire tonight.
Tonight is all that exists. Okay.
It's all about? That exists.
I want to live stream, but I guess I got to work on this album. We have features coming with GuapDad 4000. I know he's been waiting, super patient. I appreciate him. If you stumble across this video, We just had to deal with that GDPR nonsense and the other stuff, the back end stuff of a real business, you know, that we had to take care of.
I didn't get no call for a feature, man. Like, I can do auto-tune. I can do auto-tune. Why you not trying to feature your boy, man? Like,
I didn't want to call on favors all of a sudden. I didn't want to, come like, on, stress man. People.
Come on.
I didn't
want to you ain't stressing me. You ain't stressing me.
I need people who can go show up to the music video.
Oh, and yeah. Be around the models. You know what? Yeah. Let me hold off a second. Yeah. Because your music videos is a little bit different.
I was working on moving to your area, and I hope to do a lot of content with you. It's so hard. Here's one thing before we wrap it up. I'm sorry. But this is like something that like is a real problem. Like the real estate industry, if you want to rent, they're very like prejudiced off the book. It's called discrimination, housing discrimination. I don't mean to be that negative guy. But in California, if you're applying for a home to rent and they ask you for your driver's ID before you're even like accepted, that's illegal in California. But I didn't know that for a long time. And all the people were making me do that so they could see my face to see, oh, he's this person. He's going to be that way and just throw my application away. That's what happened in the majority of cases. I didn't know that discrimination was going on until my advisor talked to the president of the real estate happenings over in California, and he told him, he's a Caucasian male, he said, you know what, I'm gonna be candid with you, here's the real deal. So yeah. It's so much bull crap. I can't even move right now from PA to California because of just, it's like, how much do we have to do? Like, we change the world every day, we put people on, we create careers, and we still get treated like pieces of crap. But whatever,
you got me looking at my ID right now. Like, would I allow him to rent from me?
Would I allow him to rent from me?
Yeah, I'm looking at mine.
It's odd for me because I'm a single male. All I have is my dog. I want to move into a big house because I need space to create a family. Last house I had wasn't big enough to create a family. Now I'm trying to get a house to create a family in, and it's like I can't even get a house to create a family in if I wanted to. It's crazy.
It's crazy, man.
But it's whatever. Crazy.
Yeah.
Wish me well, guys, in California. If you got the plug on a nice house with a hot tub and a pool over 3,000 square feet, let me know. I would love to rent that place.
Somebody out there. That's why I'm on Trulia right now. Trulia, man, that's the move for us. But let me go ahead and hop up off of here, man. Always a pleasure. Always a pleasure, game. Always a pleasure, producers and creatives alike. Always glad to be here with you guys.
All right. Peace out, guys. Didn't mean to end it on such negativity, but I had to warn people. Anyway, peace out, guys.